It's 5 o'clock on the dot this Wednesday morning. I'm Ken Weaver with your top stories, and we are still under threat of severe weather. Full forecast and traffic in 5 minutes. And we always talk about this line, and we hate to say it, but pack your patience, Williamson County. Part of I-840 East will be closed for months to repair damage an excavator did to a bridge in Thompson Station. People who live along the Exit 23 detour tell Channel 4 they're worried about all that extra traffic near their homes where the speed limit, it's only 30 miles per hour.
Because Carter Creek Pike in front of my house is small. It's not a large road, so we don't need all the heavy traffic, but we do have it. But it's busy early in the morning, late in the afternoon. You just have to pick your times.
Well, Highway Patrol says at least one lane of 840 will be open to help with traffic, but they ask drivers to take that Exit 23 detour. New developments in the court battle over the Covenant school shooter's writings. Yesterday, we learned the city of Nashville has no problem releasing redacted versions of at least some of the material. Here's Channel 4's Joylynn Bukovac.
Metro's lawyer argued that the court should not force them to hand anything over right now, but they could turn over a redacted version of the journal that was found in the shooter's car.
Metro told Chancery Court Judge Aisha Miles police are still investigating whether anyone else participated in the shooting. And that's not likely to be completed until July. Now, you still have the school, church, and parents asking the court to keep the city from ever releasing the records. The Tennessean says the hearing wraps up today with arguments from the lawyer for the Covenant parents. Governor Lee's plan to give parents up to $7,000 to send their kids to private schools is stalled. But money for it has been approved. Finance committees in both the House and Senate passed versions of the state budget that includes $144 million to initiate a voucher program, whether or not legislation actually passes. There's no indication the Senate and House will make a deal in time to do it this year. Market numbers report brought to you by Beacon Capital Management. Online at beaconcm.com. Here's Daria Albinger.
Stocks slid going into the close after a strong start to the session. The Dow snapped a six-day losing streak, rising 64 points. The Nasdaq fell 20. The S&P gave up 10. The markets rose early on some strong earnings reports, including from United Health and Morgan Stanley. Trump Media and Technology wasn't so lucky. Shares continue to fall even after the company announced it would launch a TV platform. Fed Chair Jerome Powell is suggesting what a lot of people have been thinking. The central bank may have to wait a little longer before it can cut a key interest rate. He told a panel discussion that he expects inflation to slow this year, but that it would be appropriate to keep rates where they are now. Tennessee Governor Bill Lee and five of his counterparts are telling auto workers across the South that unionizing could put their jobs in jeopardy. Workers at VW's plant in Chattanooga vote this week on representation by the UAW.
All right, futures ahead of this morning's opening bell on Wall Street. Dow futures up 157, S&P up 18, NASDAQ up 37. That's the latest news. Traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Nashville's Morning News with Dan Mance.
And go, my fellow Americans.
We talk news. Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
5:06, Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Good morning to your friends. It is Wednesday, April 17th. Big news day yesterday and a lot going on today, man. We got the Mayorkas impeachment. That is now moved to the Senate. We'll talk to Congressman Mark Green, chairman of the Congressional Committee on Homeland Security, coming up at 8:05. I cannot wait for that. And at 7:35, Cameron Smith on the impasse within the state legislature on Governor Lee's voucher program. Of course, you know Cameron. He does fill in here, also writes for the Tennessean, among others. And so we'll talk to Cameron about what is going on there, which it doesn't seem like a whole heck of a lot. I think that a lot of people are saying this morning and yesterday afternoon that it looks like the voucher program is dead. I mean, what Governor Lee wanted to do, it seems like it is dead. We'll have to wait and see ultimately, obviously, what happens. But we'll get into some of the details with Cameron a little bit later on this morning on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. The only thing that I'll say about that now is that when this whole thing came out, when Governor Lee's voucher program, when it was announced, and then as the details started to become available, one of the things that I said literally on day one is that as a conservative, all of us, one of the big things that conservatives stand for is school choice. But what I also said was, is this the right plan? Is this the right plan for Tennessee right now? I mean, you would think that it would be a slam dunk, right? A Republican supermajority in the state legislature. I mean, you would think that this would be a very easy pass for the Republicans and for Governor Lee. Ha ha. Not even close. And I think that the devil is going to be in the details. And the details, of course, have been discussed, quite frankly, ad nauseum here on WTN. And so we'll get into some of that. But I don't believe that this is going to pass. One of the questions I'm going to ask Cameron is, OK, so if we were going to finger point, if we were going to say, OK, who's to blame for a super Republican majority not able to pass something that basically all Republicans stand for, which is school choice, who is to blame? Is it Governor Lee? Is it Cameron Sexton, leader of the House of Representatives? Is it the folks over in the Senate? Who's to blame? Now, remember, Governor Lee had kind of a sketch, if you will. He said, this is what I want. You folks figure out how to make it happen. And then, of course, the House got involved and they threw a lot of stuff into this legislation. And then the Senate, and that's the big battle that's going on in the House. And then in the Senate, you know, Jack Johnson and the folks over there, you know, they had a more streamlined vision of how they wanted this to go. And so now both chambers are battling. And there's, you know, the way the money is going to be spent. There's testing. There's accountability. There's strings. And so everybody has a different idea. You've got the rural counties that, you know, of course, are led by Republicans. And those Republicans have been telling the Republicans from the bigger cities and House leadership, we don't have private schools for our kids to go to. So if you're going to do this, and you're going to pass all of this funding and you're going to make all of these changes, oh, great. The rural communities are saying, oh, great, we can send our kids to a private school. The problem the rural communities have is they don't have private schools out there, or not a lot of them, not enough to handle what we're talking about. And then, of course, you have some of these big money groups. Dark money groups, the billionaires that have also been discussed quite a bit. So I don't know. It's going to be interesting to see how that turns out. I think it's going to die. And then the question is, OK, so this is going to be a big conversation heading into the elections because everybody's up for reelection. And so now you're going to talk about primaries. You're going to talk about some of the folks in the rural counties who voted against this thing. Well, then the question is, will they be primaried? And will those, and I'm going to air quote here, the dark money groups, the big money groups, are they going to fund candidates that will run against those that voted against this measure? And I think that's part of what is going to be discussed with Cameron coming up at 7:35 on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. As I said, a very big news day. And I got to tell you, yesterday with the House of Representatives finally sending the articles of impeachment to the Senate, happened yesterday afternoon, two articles of impeachment. Senator John Kennedy out of Louisiana pleading with the Senate and Chuck Schumer to take this to trial, because you know what the Democrats are doing. The Democrats run the Senate, and they're basically saying, oh, yeah, this is just going to be dismissed. There's really no evidence here. This is part of what Kennedy had to say yesterday on the Senate floor.
The United States House of Representatives. Did you notice I said that? Representatives of the United States House of Representatives came over to us. As I said the other day, we're not talking about some snow bro who likes chicken McNuggets and weed and has an opinion. We're not talking about some game boy who's living in his parents' basement and has an opinion, though both of them are entitled to their opinion. But this is America, because this is America. We're talking about the United States House of Representatives. For months, they investigated the open, bleeding wound that is the southern border. Yep. And why it is open and why it is bleeding.
Well, listen, we all know what's going on. I mean, look at anywhere online, anywhere on social media, you can see videos of what is going on the southern border. You've got, you know, the Venezuelans that come crashing through the fence. They're overrunning the border patrol, and people are horrified. Look at the crime. We see that daily. I mean, how many times have we seen videos of police officers being attacked by these Venezuelans? I mean, this is going on all across the country. We could talk about the impact financially on our communities and our schools. Look at what's happening in New York. I've got a story later on today. I'm going to try to get to it. I've got a story later on today about what is going on in New York. And I know that you know what's going on in New York. But wait, there's more, and I'll have it for you hopefully in the 6 o'clock hour. More from John Kennedy.
Two charges in an impeachment of Secretary Mayorkas. And those are serious charges. They're as serious as four heart attacks and a stroke. The first one is willful and systemic refusal to comply with the law. Not negligence, willful and systemic refusal to comply with the law. The second charge is breach of the public trust.
Boy, I got to tell you, we'll get into, and I'm not going to get hung up on the legalese of what is going on as far as what the specific laws that or the policies that Mayorkas has willfully decided not to follow. But man, you want to talk about a violation of the public trust. We'll talk about that and a whole lot more. 5:15 right now on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. It's time to check the roads. Thank you very much. Scattered thunderstorms this morning, cloudy this afternoon, a high of 80 degrees, and appreciate you listening to Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Johnny, you said it is what temperature?
69.
69 degrees at Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
Full and systemic refusal to comply with the law. Not negligence. Willful and systemic refusal to comply with the law. The second charge is breach of the public trust.
All right. So talking about, and again, that is John Kennedy on the House floor. And basically, he is telling Chuck Schumer, leader of the Senate, Democrat leader of the Senate, it is imperative that we have a trial. Basically, what they're saying, what the Republicans in the House are saying, is that Joe Biden and Alejandro Mayorkas, they are engaged in this massive catch and release program. Basically, it's all about detention and then release. Because our laws state that Biden and Mayorkas, it requires that all applicants for admission who are, quote, not clearly and beyond a doubt entitled to be admitted shall be detained for a removal proceeding. Instead, they're being released into our country. Requires that aliens placed into expedited removal proceedings and determined to have a credible fear of persecution still be detained for further consideration of the application for asylum. Instead, they're being released. Requires that an alien who is placed into expedited removal proceedings and determined not to have a credible fear of persecution shall be detained until removed. Instead, they're being released. And so I would have to ask Chuck Schumer, why exactly is it that you say, because this is what he's going to say, why exactly is it that you're going to say that there is no evidence that any laws were broken when Mark Green and Republicans in the House have specifically stated which of these laws have been broken? And it is clear that they're being broken because of Joe Biden's massive catch and release program. And that is what's going on. So now the expectation is that the Democrat-run Senate, they're simply going to dismiss these particular charges.
This has only happened 22 times. 22 times has the United States House of Representatives impeached a public official. And every single time, check it, go Google it. Every single time, you can write this down, take it home to mama. Every single time, except when the public official has quit, the United States Senate has done its job. Whether the Democrats were in the majority or the Republicans were in majority, we held a trial every single time, except when the public official quit.
Well, and you know why the Democrats in the Senate don't want, and certainly Joe Biden and Alejandro Mayorkas, they don't want a trial either. The reason why they don't want a trial is because they know that they're in the wrong. They know that the video evidence and the numbers that we're seeing, they know that this could be disastrous for Joe Biden and Alejandro Mayorkas. Also, if this ultimately ends up going to trial, you know what that's going to mean? It's going to mean that they are going to have to look at the evidence, and that evidence will point to Donald Trump was right. That's what the evidence will point to. And they simply cannot have that, right? They simply cannot have a trial where the evidence will point to Donald Trump being right. I think that this trial is important to have because it is important to the American people. By the way, do you know that Mitt Romney? Hey, Johnny or Ken, do we know, do rhinos make an actual, what is the sound of a rhino?
Crushing people underneath their feet.
Well, Mitt Romney is going to vote with the Democrats, apparently, to squash this thing because he is the ultimate anti-Trumper. And so I need a sound effect of a rhino.
Oh, that kind of rhino.
Yeah, so that I can, you know, every time I talk about Mitt Romney or some of these other rhinos, I have a fun little
maybe
sound effect.
Maybe a wiener dog squeaky toy.
Sure, maybe that's what we need. But listen, Kennedy says there is plenty of evidence.
You're going to hear one of my colleagues, the majority leader, say we don't need a whole trial. He's going to say the evidence is insufficient. I want you to think for a moment. Just ask yourself this question. How does he know the evidence isn't sufficient? How does he know? He hadn't heard the evidence.
He's right. He is absolutely right. So that is going to be a big news story today. And yeah, Mitt Romney is out there now saying this is part of the conversation where he is saying Mitt Romney opened voting with Democrats to dismiss the Mayorkas impeachment.
Why would he not want this evidence to be presented?
Because
why
it
in
would
the world?
It would prove that Donald Trump was right and Mitt Romney is the ultimate anti-Trumper on the Republican side.
Yeah.
You've got Mitt Romney and you've got the Lincoln Project. I mean, that's kind of who Mitt Romney is. Mitt Romney is basically, you know, the Lincoln Project incarnate. Now, if you don't know who the Lincoln Project is, I don't know what to tell you. Lincoln Project is a group of so-called Republicans who like to say they're Republicans, but ultimately they are a bunch of Democrats who are out to get Donald Trump. That's basically what their whole point of existence is.
Now, well, and Mitt Romney is ultra-rich, so inflation doesn't bother him either. So.
That's exactly
He wants that for another 4 years.
Mitt Romney is saying, I don't believe there is a constitutional standard met. But at the same time, I think the Senate should give a chance for debate, even if it's limited to 2 hours, Romney said. So it sounds like he is sort of going back and forth on this whole thing. But I think the American people need to hear this. I think that the American people want to hear this. And I think that for the Republicans in the Senate, they really need to try to figure out a way to force this through. But listen, when the other side of the aisle, when they are as political as they are, and that's what the Democrats are, well, Republicans are too, they see that they will be in political peril if this ultimately goes to trial, because then we see the evidence. And as you have John Kennedy saying, that Chuck Schumer has not seen the evidence. Oh, here's the thing that I would counter with John Kennedy, and perhaps I'll ask Mark Green this at 8:05 when he joins us. Mark Green, chairman of the Congressional Committee on Homeland Security. I think that Chuck Schumer knows all too well what that evidence is, and that's why he doesn't want the American people to see that evidence. And so we'll talk about that and a whole lot more. 5:23 on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. April is here, and with it, springtime weather. It is important to have quality windows in your home. Now, if your windows won't open to let in the fresh air, won't seal tight to keep out the pollen and the bugs, or they've been leaking water all winter, then it is time you spoke to the experts at Window Nation. And right now, they've got a great deal for listeners to my show. For every two windows that you buy, you're going to get two windows absolutely free. There's no limit as to how much money you could save. Plus, you could save even more with no interest or payments for 24 months. Window Nation's windows come with a lifetime warranty, and yes, they can be installed in 1 day or less. With proven quality and service, when you buy from Window Nation, you can rest assured that you are getting affordable windows that meet or beat the ones from the national brand names. So don't miss out on this fantastic opportunity to afford quality windows with an unlimited buy two, get two free, plus zero interest or payments for 24 months. You cannot afford to wait, and it's really easy. Just call Window Nation, 866-90-NATION, 866-90-NATION. Tell them Dan told you to reach out. You can find them online. It is windownation.com to schedule your free in-home estimate.
The guaranteed offer is the easiest way to sell your home. It's really simple. We bring you an all-cash offer. You close in as little as 21 days. No home inspections, no lockboxes, no open houses. Go to markspain.com to get a guaranteed offer and start packing.
Five 5:30 on the dot this Wednesday morning. I'm Ken Weaver with your top stories. And drivers, you are the top story this morning. Heads up in Williamson County, a portion of I-840 East will be down to one lane for months while repairs are made to an overpass in Thompson Station. Drivers are being asked to take the exit 23 detour to Carter's Creek Pike, even though that one lane of 840 will be open. And right now, about an hour and a half drive east of Nashville on I-24, there is a crash involving several vehicles, and the interstate is shut down both directions at Mont Eagle. I'm looking at a TDOT camera of it right now, and it looks like there's a semi on its side, and there is smoke pouring from the cab of this semi. And there's no telling when 24 both directions will be reopened there in Mont Eagle. So if you've got plans to be in Chattanooga today, you better start planning a new route. Later today in Nashville, Channel 4's Jordan James says there will be more marching with signs and chanting by groups who are opposed to things like school vouchers and arming teachers and staff.
More than 20 organizations from across the state will be marching through downtown and making their way towards Legislative Plaza to address issues considered by them to be harmful.
Yeah, look for all of that to happen around 3 o'clock today. And this morning marks another day of hearings over the Covenant school shooters' writings and whether they should be released to the public. Yesterday, we learned Metro Nashville has no problem releasing a redacted version of the shooter's manifesto, which was found in her car that day, but not until after police wrap up investigating whether anyone else was involved. That may not happen until July. And money news, not the kind you want to hear, especially if you're wanting to buy or sell a home.
President Biden touting his economic record while campaigning in Scranton, Pennsylvania Tuesday. At the same time, the Federal Reserve chair signaled stubborn inflation will likely delay any interest rate drops until later this year.
The recent data have clearly not given us greater confidence.
Especially when it comes to the labor and housing markets. High mortgage rates and low inventory are keeping many wannabe homeowners on the sidelines, especially in Boston, where the Boston Globe reports the median price for a single-family home in March reached a record $900,000.
That's the latest news. Traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Thank you, Ken. 5:32, Nashville's Morning News. Friends, spring is here. And that means it is time to think about lawnmowers, and DT McCall's is thinking about their customers and lawnmowers. Now, they're having a huge customer appreciation sale coming up on Saturday, April 20th. So that is this weekend. It's going to be at their Carthage location. Look for huge discounts across the entire store at DT McCall's Carthage location. They're going to have drawings for prizes, including a Pit Boss grill, a Samsung robot vacuum, and DeWalt handheld tools, to name just a few. This is a massive event, again, Saturday, April 20th, at the DT McCall's in Carthage. Great savings across the store as we celebrate you, the customers of DT McCall's. And if you aren't a customer yet, you really should be, because DT McCall's is one of Tennessee's finest stores, and their Carthage location is the place to be coming up on Saturday, April 20th. By the way, you can also save big on Dixie Chopper lawnmowers. They say the world's fastest lawnmower. So check out all the great deals that await you at their Customer Appreciation Day. DT McCall's at their Carthage location. Find out details at their website, dtmccalls.com, this coming Saturday.
Populations of animals. I mean, think about the white-tailed deer and how when Ed started, and maybe even before Ed a little bit, they started, you know, working to bring these populations back. And now we have these sustainable populations that we can hunt.
Yeah.
You know, the story of the eastern wild turkey and what's happening with turkeys. So I would consider all these things great successes. The conservation efforts that have been worked on by the personnel for years, I would think that it's a great success story for our state.
You're going to see some footage from an old film that was produced here at the agency in the Game and Fish days, and which shows some things like, you know, the wife taking care of the animal that the officer, the husband, had to bring home to take care of, you know, because they got a call. And times have changed. Now we have the rehabilitators that help out with that kind of thing. And
thank goodness. We got to be really good friends with some of those little animals. And my first commission, 1972.
Okay, yeah.
At that time, it was a little different, you know, the whole law enforcement world was different then. Yeah. So anyway, we got the first commission in 1972 and worked all over the state. It was really great to be able to do that. Pretty much, you had one uniform. And I noticed in the movie too, everybody wearing ties. You know, for years and years, you had to, if you wore a long sleeve shirt, you had to wear a tie. It didn't matter if you were doing enforcement or standing in a pond or whatever you were doing, you had that tie on.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
And then everybody looked forward. There was one date, and it kind of moved. But generally around April 1st, you switched from long sleeves to short sleeves, and you didn't have to wear a tie. And everybody's going, come on, April 1st.
Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk, Ben and 97 WTN. Time for the Gang of Three Amigos. Johnny's here. Good morning, Johnny.
Good morning.
Ken Weaver is here. Good morning, Ken.
Not good morning, boys. Yes.
Well, this radio program brought to you by Loose Oily Stools.
Oh, God.
How many times are we going to have to hear the Loose Oily Stool commercial?
Several times.
It's 537. Until, three times so far.
Until I think it's been four, cure, actually. Boys. Until
that's right.
There's a cure.
I think it's actually been four, Dan.
I'll
four?
Tell you what,
yeah.
I'll tell you what's a loose, oily stool in Tennessee, and that's I-24.
Oh, you're not kidding.
Good what? Grief, man.
So what is caused this? Is it a complete closure to coming and going?
Yeah, both directions of 24 and Mont Eagle are completely shut down. From what I'm looking at, it looks like a semi has overturned on its side, but the report is that several vehicles are involved. I think the reason both directions are shut down is the fire department needs apparatus on both sides to fix whatever has happened there. And it happens to be in that part of 24 where there's kind of a sharp turn there at Mont Eagle. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that has anything to do with the crash, but, man, there are a lot of fire trucks and first responders down there on the scene. And right now, nothing is moving.
So the question is, number one, was there a load in the semi?
I don't know.
All right. Because if there's a load in the semi, then perhaps it's spilled and you got to clean all that up. And how bad is the backup thus far?
Bad.
Is it? So if you're going...
It's going to be miles. If you've got plans in Chattanooga today, you better leave right now and take another route.
Is there a way around that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, they're back ways.
Yeah, there's back ways, but there's... Okay. You know, there's...
Of course, you know, when this happens, the back ways get all screwed up, too.
Well, yeah. You're talking about a very, you know, almost mountainous area.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that's going to be another...
Which is probably why the semi, you know, flipped over.
Yeah, already 41 to Mont Eagle. It's already showing up red now on the T-Dot map.
Okay.
Smartway map. Pack your patience.
Pack your patience.
Listen, pack like a coffee can or something because there's no bathrooms around. And
well, there's plenty of woods.
Pack a diaper.
You know what? I wonder... Maybe out of if you're like an adult and you can't hold it, just, you know, pack your pull-ups.
Yeah,
you know, exactly. Instead of pack your patience, pack your pull-ups. You got to go to the bathroom, man. Just take off your pants and put on some pull-ups.
I tell you, 24.
I'm just kidding, people.
I-24, I try to avoid it at all costs. It is just that's a nasty interstate.
It can be some nasty business for sure, yes, boy. Sir.
I try to avoid leaving my house.
I do, too.
Because, you know, I basically come to work and I go home. That's like, that is what I like to do.
That's me, too.
Yes, sir.
Hey, by the way, I've got some audio here, and somebody just sent it to me. I have not heard it, but the link says this. Biden tells a bizarre, incoherent story from decades ago about answering his motel room door.
Okay.
While he was standing in a towel and shaving cream.
Let's hear it.
Now, I have not heard this, so we'll just go ahead and react together, shall we? Yeah.
One day I showed up at off-year convention, and I was in the motel, after the local motel, getting changed after the afternoon session, go back to the evening session. I'd come down with some young activists, a little older than me, but still young activists, who were involved in trying to reform the party. And I was in one of those 8x10 bathrooms, you know, they have shower, toilet, and a sink. And I got a towel on me and shaving cream, and I hear bam, bam, bam at my door really loudly. And I wonder, what the hell is that? I thought it was this guy, Bob Cunningham, had a radio show, and a couple other guys. So I said, okay, guys. And I walked to the door and opened it up, and standing there was the former governor of the state of Delaware, Albert N. Carville, a big guy, about 6'5", talked at you like this. And the state representative who got defeated 4 years earlier as a Democratic state rep who was retired. And one of the, from the family that had more senators appointed than any other family in American history to the tunnels, and a former retired justice and the state chairman. And they said, I'm standing at the towel.
There you go. That is Joe Biden.
Okay, so there were four people standing at the door.
I guess so. That's what he says.
And he was there with a young activist.
Who was young, but they were a little bit older than he was at the time.
And he was in nothing but a towel and shaving cream, says Joe Biden.
Boy, that's a bizarre story.
You ever watch read the comments when...
This what guy's, prompted that?
One guy says, Joe Biden isn't mentally fit to microwave popcorn, let alone be president.
Well, that's the truth.
You know, here's what I would say, is that when his stories start...
One day I showed up at off-year convention.
And that low sort of gravelly...
And I was in...
You know what it sounds like? When I hear his voice, you know what I think of?
Local motel. Beep. Changed after the afternoon beep. Session. Go back to the evening
yes.
session.
Beep.
I'd come down with some young activist. A little older than
and I'm just, it just sounds like only a matter of time before it goes, beep.
Yeah, it does.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Good Lord, man.
Push on that poor foil. I can barely breathe.
I just wonder what prompted this story.
Yeah, well, that's strange.
What? I mean.
I don't know.
Well, and too, what really concerned me, the young activist. who was older than he was.
Yeah, what did that have to do with?
Yeah, and I'd like to know more about the young activist and what were they doing in the motel room with Joe.
Right. Is that the reason he was in a towel and shaving cream?
You know what? Inquiring minds perhaps want to know. I don't really want to know, to be honest with you. The thought of Joe Biden in a towel is more than I can handle at 5:43 in the morning, but whatever.
Just ask anybody that's been at that pool.
Yeah.
When Joe takes a little
dip. Where's Corn Pop when you need him? Joe needs his legs rubbed.
Yeah, and why were they banging on the door? Why was the 6'5" former governor of Delaware banging on his door?
And he talks like this.
Was maybe...
You know what? Red State... You know what's interesting, Ken? Red State, this is where I got this. Red State even says, what is even the point of this story? If he's talking about organizers slash activists going out to campaign for him, that's not exactly encouraging them.
No.
He also told these people about a big lie about being ahead of Donald Trump. He said that he has been to every single of the toss-up states. Then he poo-pooed polls. And he claimed, guess what, even in the polls that are being used now, we're ahead in 35 polls. He's really not.
I was worried there was a period after poo-pooed.
Well, we are
that would have been something.
We are the morning show of loose, oily stools.
Yes, we are.
Goodness gracious.
Should I let that go? I should probably stop.
Well, people are having breakfast. I would.
Here's what Biden says about the polls.
I've been to every single of the toss-up states so far. And guess what? Beep. If you knock anybody knows anything about polling, it's awful hard to poll these days. Because, no, I'm serious. But guess what? Even in the polls that are being used now, we're ahead in 35 polls.
Okay.
Boy, that is a... Sounds more like a lie detection there, Dan, than...
Yeah.
I like how he, quote, poo-poos the polls, but then touts the polls.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, that's exactly right. I don't know.
Maybe the towel was too tight.
You know, I do wonder when, because there's a number of different dynamics here. Number one is Biden is out, and this is part of the headlines today. Biden is out campaigning while Donald Trump is stuck in a courtroom. We talked about that quite a bit yesterday with his hush money trial. Do you think that the more that people see of, you know, brain dead Biden, the worse it's going to be for him because of moments just like this?
Well, that's why they don't show him on the mainstream.
No, and what's helping Biden, I think, is John Mellencamp stopping concerts to try to help Joe.
That's exactly, you know, we talked about that
yesterday.
Trying to
beat up audience members that, you know, protest.
You know, it's interesting because he talked about that yesterday. John Mellencamp did, because we played the audio, and the audio went viral, as you can imagine. And so one of the things that Mellencamp said, I actually have the audio. Just for people that missed the later part of the show yesterday, this is John Mellencamp. And he is yelling at people in the audience in Toledo, Ohio. If you missed this, it is must hear. Guy is screaming, hey, John, can you maybe, oh, I don't know, we're at a concert. Can you maybe play some of your music?
What do you think I mean, Jimmy, you sucker? Now, here's the thing, man. You don't know me. You don't f***ing know me. Hey, Joe, find this guy and let me see him after the show. Guys, I can stop this show right now and just go home. Tell you what I'm going to do. Since you've been so wonderful, I'm going to cut about 10 songs out of the show. Here we go. A little ditty. Back, Jack, down.
Wait for it.
Show's over.
Show's over, and he walks off the stage.
There you go, folks.
That's what he did.
Oh, Johnny Cougar.
Oh, Johnny Cougar out there. Oh, Johnny really cares about his fans.
Johnny Cougar Mellenhead.
You know, and so now he says, you know, my show isn't really a concert. It's more like a presentation.
It's not even that.
Where he wants to, by the way, can I didn't know this was going to come up, but you have to look at the video because you know what he's wearing?
A towel?
And shaving a towel cream? And shave cream? No, he's wearing like, it's like a onesie for a man. I look at the video.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, I'll try to find it.
You're kidding me.
No, go.
Oh, I've got to
see it. Folks, if you're, Google John Cougar or John Mellencamp and, you know, yells at audience, whatever, and you'll see the video.
And a onesie.
And it's like he's wearing, I don't even know how to describe it, but it's like he's wearing a onesie for a man. It's like what something an old time mechanic might wear, perhaps.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't understand. But John Mellencamp, certainly a man of the people there.
Oh, definitely.
You know?
Show's over.
There you go. John Mellencamp.
Show's over. Yeah. More ways than one, John.
Oh, yeah. It looks like.
What is that he's wearing?
It looks
wearing?
Like a mechanic's onesie.
It looks like a mechanic's onesie.
I thought I had something else in mind.
What did you think?
Well, there was. Something going around Nashville where, like, I think some pledges at one of the colleges was some male pledges were forced to wear some onesies, but they were short onesies.
You mean like you just put on a toddler?
Yes.
Okay.
That's what I thought you were talking about. Little ditty about Jack and Diane.
Wearing onesies as much as we can.
There you go.
Maybe we should get told John, maybe, we could get him a gift. Maybe we could get him an octopus.
Sure, an octopus for a sourpuss.
By the way, guys, there is an update to the octopus. If you remember from the show the other day, if you missed it, there's an Oklahoma family. It was a dentist in Oklahoma that bought an octopus for his son. His son always wanted one since he was three. And so they get the octopus home. They name it Terrence. And Terrence turns out to be a female and hatched 50 octopuses, whatever you want to call them.
Yes.
Anyway, we got an update. Terrence is on its last legs. Terrence is about to check out.
Oh.
The octopus is about to die.
Yeah, that is normal. But anyway, the family's very happy because they're getting a lot of attention, which if you really want to get to the bottom of it, I think that's what this dentist wanted. He wanted a little attention. Maybe for his son. Maybe his son's not, popular at school or something.
Yes.
But anyway, they've had 50 offspring, and now the offspring are being sent to various colleges, various...
Red lobsters.
Yeah.
Rock and roll sushi.
Oh, my God.
By the way,
that was the line of the day.
So just so folks know, so apparently...
wearing just a towel and some shaving cream.
The octopi is about to die.
Yes, and the mother
is. All of the little baby octopi are going off to various places.
Now, go ahead, Brother Johnny B.
Well, I was just going to say that the family is also donating money to these various institutions that are taking these octopi, whatever.
Octopuses.
And
it just sounds awkward.
Yeah, it does. It sounds.
That's why I said yesterday the official Nashville's Morning News pronunciation is going to be octopi.
Okay, octopi. I like that. So anyway, and they're also selling swag. The family is.
Of course they are.
Yeah, with Terrence likeness on the.
By the way, I'm getting excoriated on the Members Nutrition Super Text line, which I'm monitoring at 615-737-9986.
Yeah, what about?
I called what Cougar was wearing, a onesie.
Yeah. Yes.
They're like coveralls. One guy says, good God almighty, Mandis, they're coveralls.
That's what they are. That's right.
Well, there is one where, yeah, he does have coveralls on, but then one is, I guess, a mechanic's coverall.
I don't
that's
get it.
That's what it is.
So that's what he's trying to be as a mechanic? He may be working as a mechanic.
First of all, dude hasn't had a hit in how many years?
Oh, it's been a
while. You ever wonder why people that are so successful become so bitter? What is his problem? He's got plenty of money.
He's always been bitter, though. I mean, even when he was hot, I remember when he came through Birmingham, I was working down there, and we were trying to, of course, as radio people do, because, you know, radio people aren't paid a lot. And we're usually given free tickets in those days. And Mellencamp came back and said, no, they have to pay for them like everybody else. Which, you know, okay, I understand that. But he's just always been just kind of a curmudgeon.
Yeah. Well, and unfortunately for the fans of John Cougar Mellencamp, Mellencamp Cougar John, you know, they get treated very hostily by the guy that they have spent a lot of money going to see. And you know what? I hope this video goes viral because he has been relegated now to, he's not playing Bridgestone, folks. He's playing, you know, small theaters, if yes. you will. So, and I don't know if that's by choice or not. Whatever.
So he'll be coming, I guess, to Springwater here in Nashville.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. All right, 5:54. Ken Weaver, what's coming up in the news?
All right, so 840 East in Williamson County is going to be closed for months to repair damage to the overpass there at Thompson Station. Only one lane will be open. And then on 24 in Monteagle, both directions are closed for a crash. That's about an hour and a half drive east of Nashville. So if you got to be in Chattanooga this morning, you need to find another route. New developments in the court battle over the Covenant school shooters' writings. We've got that for you at 6 on Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
I'm John Morgan of Morgan & Morgan. If you've been injured in a car accident, call America's largest injury law firm. For over 35 years, my mission has been to deliver more for our clients, to deliver more for you. If you or anyone in your family has been injured in a car accident, call us now, as the time to file a claim may be limited. Last year, more clients hired Morgan & Morgan than ever before. Protecting America, fighting for you, Morgan & Morgan. Visit forthepeople.com for an office near you.
Time to say goodbye to the one-size-fits-all approach. This is Brian Wilson for the tailored weight loss programs at Restoration Wellness and Med Spa, where they take into account your unique needs, lifestyle, and goals. Whether you're looking to shed those extra pounds, boost your energy, or improve your overall health, Restoration Wellness has the solution for you. Join more than 1,000 patients who have already seen life-changing results from the team at Restoration Wellness. Give them a call at 615-470-8124 or visit them at Restoration Wellness and Med Spa. Is it time to buy a new mattress? Before buying online, consider getting your next mattress at DT McCall's, where you always get free delivery and haul away with no hidden fees. At DT McCall's, you have access to Dutch craft mattresses, including the Dr. J collection. These Amish handcrafted all-American made in Tennessee mattresses were designed by a top chiropractor skilled in treating back pain, superior to the leading national brands and priced hundreds less. Check out one of their five locations in Carthage, Lafayette, Cookeville, Lebanon, and Franklin, or online at DTMcCalls.com.
You expect your home to protect everything you love, but you don't expect the ways water is breaking down your foundation and damaging your home. Cracks in walls and uneven floors are just a few signs your foundation is compromised. But there's one way to get answers to all your concerns. A free home inspection from AFS. We put water back in its place. Get your free inspection at afsrepair.com. License number CBC 126-4246 68623.
WTN, Hendersonville, Nashville. From the Busy Bee Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling Studios.
And the Mark Spain Real Estate WTN Newsroom.
Information-fueled, opinion-driven.
This is Nashville's news and talk leader.
Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
6 o'clock on the dot this Wednesday morning. I'm Ken Weaver with your top stories, and we are still under threat of severe weather. Full forecast and traffic coming up in 5 minutes. Drivers, we hate to say it, but pack your patience, especially in Williamson County this morning. Part of I-840 East is going to be closed for months to repair damage to a bridge in Thompson Station. At least one lane is going to be open on the interstate, but drivers are still asked to take the exit 23 detour. And if you have to be in Chattanooga today, you might want to map out an alternate route. Right now, 24 is shut down both directions at Mont Eagle due to a crash. Here in Nashville, new developments in the court battle over the Covenant school shooter's writings. Yesterday, we learned the city of Nashville has no problem releasing redacted versions of at least one of the materials. Here's Channel 4's Joylyn Bukovac.
Metro's lawyer argued that the court should not force them to hand anything over right now, but they could turn over a redacted version of the journal that was found in the shooter's car.
Metro told Chancery Court Judge Aisha Miles, police are still investigating whether anyone else participated in the massacre, and it's likely not going to be completed until July. Governor Lee's plan to give parents up to $7,000 to send their kids to private schools is stalled, but money for it has been approved. The Tennessean says finance committees in both the House and Senate passed versions of the state budget. That includes $144 million to initiate a voucher program, whether or not legislation actually passes. There's no indication the Senate and House are going to make a deal in time to do it this year. Market Numbers Report brought to you by Beacon Capital Management, online at beaconcm.com. Here's Jim Ryan.
We may be stuck with higher interest rates for a while longer. After a third consecutive month of hotter than expected inflation, Federal Reserve Chair Jerome Powell says the current policies may need more time to work, dashing hopes for several interest rate cuts starting this summer. Despite the gloomy outlook, the Dow Jones on Tuesday managed a 64-point gain to close at 37,799. The NASDAQ composite slipped 0.1%. The S&P logged its third straight day of losses, giving up 0.2%. The Brits, on the other hand, are getting a break. Inflation in the UK fell to its lowest level in 2.5 years in March after a further easing of food prices. Demand for luxury is dipping. The company behind Louis Vuitton, Tiffany, and Bulgari says sales growth in the first quarter slowed to only 3%. Last month, the parent company to Gucci warned about a 10% drop in sales for this year.
All right, let's check futures ahead of this morning's opening on Wall Street. Right now, Dow futures are up 173, S&P up 21, NASDAQ up 50. That's the latest news. Traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Matt Murphy for Members Nutrition. I want to tell you about the Members Nutrition difference, and I want to encourage you to go over to the Members Nutrition website. Number one, they believe at Members Nutrition that they can sell vitamins and supplements at a lower cost point, and they're doing it every single day at membersnutrition.com. Number two, They want to make these products right here in the United States of America, not from some overseas company, and they do that every single day. I encourage you to go to membersnutrition.com. You'll get 50% off your purchase price at checkout. You don't have to put in any codes. Just go to membersnutrition.com. Once again, membersnutrition.com.
Children can be a wonderful joy. Their laughter, their energy, their amazement often brightens our day. Yet if your child is easily distracted, makes careless mistakes, or doesn't listen when spoken to, you may be dealing with ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. It's a chronic condition that affects both children and adults. Many adults suffer for years before they get help. While there are exceptions, medications generally appear to have a stronger effect on ADHD symptoms than non-medication interventions. It's important to have a partnership between the child's parents, teachers, and medical professionals. For greater counseling, visit me at Nolensville Psychiatry, located in the back of Britton Plaza on Nolensville Road, for your privacy. This is Dr. Christopher Van Schaank checking in on your mental health.
To learn more about the services provided by Dr. Van Schaank, visit his website at NolensvillePsychiatry.com and book an appointment.
Looks like things still shut down around that wreck here both directions at Mont Eagle if you're headed southbound this morning. Starting to see some volume pick up between Smyrna and Laverne here on 24. Also, 24 into 65, some stop and go on the north side. And 65 out of Franklin and Brentwood still looking pretty quiet. Also, 40 east in good shape still coming out of Bellevue. I'm Jack Wellback. Traffic every 10 minutes every morning on Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
From the Beacon Capital Management Weather Center. We talk news. Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
6:06, Nashville's morning news on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Welcome on in along with Johnny B, Ken Weaver, Dan Mandis here. Joy Reid said something I thought was very indicative. It's almost like, as some folks are saying, that she is saying the quiet part out loud. And I'm going to play you the audio. It does have to do with Donald Trump. And it does have to do with what the president, who is currently engaged in his hush money trial over the money paid to Stormy Daniels. But remember, this is just one of several legal issues that the former president is facing. You've got, of course, the hush money trial. You've got the situation going on in Atlanta. You've also got the state of New York going after Donald Trump as well. And of course, the hush money trial is courtesy of the Democrats and Alvin Bragg, the DA there in Manhattan. And so I'm going to play you this audio from Joy Reid. And I do believe the audio speaks for itself, but I want you to listen to it anyway.
For me, there is something wonderfully poetic about the fact that despite the fact that even if convicted, he's not going to go to prison. The first person to actually criminally prosecute Donald Trump is a black Harvard grad, the very kind of person that his former staff, the people who worked for him, Stephen Miller, et cetera, want to never be at Harvard law school. But he was. And he came out and graduated. And he's prosecuting you, Donald.
You know, one of my questions would be, she's talking about Stephen Miller and other people within the Trump administration. And she says Stephen Miller would never want someone like him, I'm assuming she means black, going to Harvard. And I just wonder, what proof does she have of that? I mean, if I'm Stephen Miller or if I'm anyone involved in the Trump administration, I would say, well, can you be more specific? Why exactly is it that you're saying that Miller or other people within the Trump administration wouldn't want Alvin Bragg to go to Harvard? It just doesn't make any sense. But of course, she's bringing race into this whole thing, and that's what Joy Reid does. She's kind of like a one-trick pony.
And a black woman is doing that same exact thing in Georgia, and a black woman forced you to pay a $175 million fine that's out now also in question because the people who put it up, that might not be legit. Donald Trump is being held to account by the very multicultural, multiracial democracy that he's trying to dismantle. And for me, there's something poetic and actually wonderful about that. It says something good about our country that we're still capable of having that happen. Go DEI. My DEIs are bringing it home on today.
Yeah, okay. DEI is bringing it home. Here's my question.
By the very multicultural, multiracial democracy that he's trying to dismantle.
What multiracial democracy is Donald Trump trying to dismantle? Can somebody explain that to me? Because the last time I checked, Trump was all about the economy. Trump was all about protecting America. It had nothing to do with trying to dismantle multiracial democracy. So, you know, this is just the same kind of racial BS that MSNBC is known for, and it is rather ridiculous. But then I started thinking about the folks that Joy Reid is talking about, you know, the wonderful DEI diversity, you know, coalition that is going after Donald Trump. Well, she's making it, of course, again, all about race. But think about the individuals that she's talking about. Alvin Bragg, the DA over one of the most crime-ridden districts in America, Manhattan. Incredibly woke. And there's a lot of people that are really angry at Alvin Bragg because the crime is so out of control. And yet here he is focusing on Donald Trump. And most people on both sides say that Alvin Bragg, this, according to Joy Reid, some, you know, DEI champion, in this particular situation, he's inept and incompetent. Most people on both sides of the aisle, by the way, say that this case is doomed to fail. So congratulations, DEI champion Alvin Bragg. We'll have to see what happens. But also realize and remember, and we spoke to many people about this, that Alvin Bragg had to be bullied into bringing this hush money case because he initially decided against bringing this, but then he had to be bullied into it by others within his staff. So that's number one. She also is talking about Joy Reid, talking about Fannie Willis, you know, the Fulton County DA who had an affair with a married man, should have been taken off the case because she was using taxpayer dollars to fund her affair. Many people said that she should have been pulled from the case because of that corruption. And somehow Joy Reid believes that Fannie Willis is some sort of, you know, DEI champion. And of course, there's Letitia James, the attorney general out of New York, who her case seems incredibly thin, basically going after Donald Trump for elevating the value of his properties when many folks say Donald Trump did all of this correctly, including the banks. And so the people that were even involved in that case that Letitia James is bringing says he did absolutely nothing wrong. So when Joy Reid says, oh, yeah, we've got all of these, you know, DEI champions or whatever it is that you want to say, the DEI coalition going after Donald Trump. You know, to me, it kind of, you know, even further delegitimizes these cases. Because I don't think any of these cases are legitimate. And say what you will about the the attorneys general or the prosecutors, the DAs that are bringing these cases, say what you will about them. But it seems to me they're all not only corrupt, but they're also not good at their jobs. They're inept at their jobs. And Letitia James, let's face it, you know, and I know, because I've told you many times, she was out to get Trump on the campaign trail. When she was saying, out on the campaign trail, telling the people of New York, I will get Donald Trump. So I don't think that Joy Reid, in her comments, when you look very specifically at these various DAs and attorneys general and so forth and all of these prosecutors, they look corrupt and incompetent. That's what they look like. And I don't believe that that has anything to do with their color, the color of their skin. I think that that has everything to do with the fact that they are agenda-driven Democrats trying to keep Donald Trump off the campaign trail, which is exactly what's happening in New York. As Joe Biden is out there making campaign stop after campaign stop in Pennsylvania over the next couple of days, and he made some yesterday as well. He's all over the place, Joe Biden is. Donald Trump is stuck in that Manhattan courtroom. And it's wrong. And everyone who has looked at this story and looked at what the Democrats are trying to do and looked at the fact that this is lawfare, using the law to target your political enemy, that's what Joe Biden and the Democrats are doing. And ultimately, what they're trying to do is they understand that they cannot beat Donald Trump on the issues, so they'll try and go after him utilizing the legal system. And that is exactly what they're doing. And I believe that there's a lot of people in America, even people on the left, who see what's going on. Joy Reid and the folks over there at MSNBC, they are so incredibly blinded by their anti-Trumpism, their Trump derangement syndrome, and their blinding partisanship, that they don't see that what they're doing is wrong. I believe that they believe that what they are doing is the right thing, the ultimate means to an end. Keep Donald Trump out of the White House because he is, I mean, you name the talking points. He's a threat to democracy. He's going to dismantle our multicultural country, whatever in the heck that means. It doesn't mean anything. It's a bunch of BS gobbledygook talking points from Joy Reid and a lot of these folks on the left. It doesn't make any sense unless you are, again, blinded by your anti-Donald Trump partisanship. It is 6:16. Time to check the roads from the WTN Traffic Center. Thank you very much. Scattered thunderstorms this morning, cloudy this afternoon, and a high of 80 degrees. Right now, 69 at Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Just very quickly, some of the day two highlights of Donald Trump's hush money trial out of New York. Justice Juan Merchan accused Donald Trump of intimidating a juror who was called in to clarify the defense claims of alleged anti-Trump Facebook posts. The judge said that Trump was audibly uttering something before issuing a stern warning. I won't tolerate that. I won't have any jurors intimidated in this courtroom. I will be crystal clear, the judge said. I guess this particular juror said a lot of nasty things about Trump on Facebook. Seven jurors have been selected so far to serve on the jury for Trump's hush money trial. The first batch started at 96 people Monday, but dwindled down after seven bowed out after the first day. Only six were picked following several challenges from both parties for the six-week trial. You know, one of the things that I'll say, and then I'll move on, is that And we talk about this all the time, friends, where this is still New York. This is still Manhattan. And in Manhattan, it is incredibly difficult to find anyone who is going to be either pro-Donald Trump. And that's not what I want, by the way. I want a neutral jury. That's what I want. How easy do you think it's going to be to find a neutral jury from incredibly blue, incredibly anti-Donald Trump Manhattan? And it's really weird, too, because Donald Trump, I mean, he helped build that city. And so I'll tell you what my fear is. What my fear is, because listen, as much as I abhor Democrats, they're not a dumb group of people. I mean, they can't figure out what the hell a woman is, but they're not a group of dumb people. And so you're going to have people that know exactly what they're supposed to say. And what they're supposed to say is that they don't have any opinion one way or another on Donald Trump. They can be fair and they can be unbiased and, you know, they should be on that jury. And we don't really know what's in their heart. And by the way, it does go both ways. There could be some pro-Trump people in there as well that know exactly what to say to get on that jury and then do what they need to do. I suspect, though, that we'll have more people on the Democrat side that are hell-bent on just going after Donald Trump, saying the right things to get on the jury, saying the right things to get in the room and in the jury box. And then when the time comes, they'll vote the way that they're going to vote and do whatever they can to convict Donald Trump, to ensure that he is damaged heading into November. To me, that's what they're trying to do. Now, one of the things I think that may happen is that this is, by all accounts, the weakest of the cases against Donald Trump. It is the very weakest. And yet it ended up being first. And so if Trump ultimately is found not guilty in this case, well, that's going to be terrible for the Democrats, obviously. Because then you're going to have the American people say, boy, all of the airtime from the networks to CNN to MSNBC, all of the social media said that Donald Trump did this horrible thing. And just like Russian collusion and many, many, many other accusations of Donald Trump, it will fall flat. So anyway, we'll have to see what happens. It is 6:21 on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. The members' nutrition, and by the way, today is an off day, so I'm not sure what the former president has planned for today, if he's hitting the campaign trail. I will tell you, though, it turns out that the former president was able to stay awake all day yesterday during the proceedings. 6:21, the Members Nutrition Hotline is 615-737-9986. Dan Mandis here. So who do you trust when it comes to your money? Now, me, I turned to Paul Winkler years ago. And a lot of these other financial folks, you know, they do say different things. But when you listen to those financial people, they all have something to sell. So you've got to be cynical because what they're doing is they're pitching their own product. So if you worked for a car company, wouldn't you say that your car is the best? Well, it's the same thing with the banks and insurance agents who sell investment products. The only thing Paul Winkler is trying to do is look out for your best interests. And he's not going to try and sell you something. He's actually going to teach you how to relax about money. Now, you need to know that I do get paid every time I do these commercials, but I wouldn't be doing them if I didn't believe in Paul Winkler and his guidance. As I said, I've been working with Paul Winkler for years and years. Now, you'll believe in Paul, too, when you call him for a free consultation. As always, tell him Dan Mandis told you to reach out, 615-851-1950, 615-851-1950 for Paul Winkler. You can also find him online at paulwinkler.com. 10 offices across Middle Tennessee, no doubt one near you, 615-851-1950, paulwinkler.com. 6:22, Ken Weaver, what's coming up in the news?
Well, drivers in Williamson County face a longer commute because 840 eastbound is going to be down to one lane for about 3 months in Thompson Station. We'll tell you why. 24, still slow going, but at least some lanes are open there in Monteagle this morning where there was a fiery crash. And bad news if you are in a hurry to buy or sell a home. All this and more at 6:30 on Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
What an absolute mess. Hey, it's Dan Mandis. Look at my closets. Unorganized to say the least. Even my window dormer is a train wreck. Stuff is everywhere. Now, luckily, California Closets is coming to my rescue. My personal design consultant, Vince, stopped by, measured, and is now showing me how to become more space efficient and organized on his 3D CAD system. It is amazing. And soon, my space is going to be organized, and yes, even Bandit approves. California Closets, a local company that can customize the storage in any room of your house. California Closets, what can they do for you? Find them online at californiaclosets.com and reach out for your free in-home consultation.
Six 27,
Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Okay, coming up next. By the way, got a lot going on today. 7:35, Cameron Smith is going to join us. Now, you know Cameron. He does fill-in work here on WTN, and he also writes for the Tennessean, a whole bunch of other papers across the state. And he's going to give us an update on what is going on within the state legislature on the governor's voucher program. Definitely an impasse, and most people are now saying that it is dead. We'll have to see what happens. We'll talk with Cameron at 7:35. My take on it is I don't think it's going to pass. We'll talk about that with Cameron coming up at 7:35. 8:05, Mark Green, chairman of the Congressional Committee on Homeland Security. He will be joining us as well. The articles of impeachment against Alejandro Mayorkas made it over to the Senate, and that was yesterday. afternoon. So we'll get Chairman and Congressman Green's opinion on what's going to happen to those articles of impeachment in the Senate. Very, very big debate going on now as to whether or not Chuck Schumer will just completely dismiss the charges and there will be no trial, or will the evidence be heard? We'll talk about that as well coming up on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. So again, lots going on. Also coming up, I want you to go to my Twitter feed, at Dan Mandis Show. You are going to see a horrific video. And it is a horrific video of a student beating up a teacher. And it was caught on video. And this is in North Carolina. And the response, I believe, will shock you. So go watch the video. And we're going to talk about that story coming up on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. At 6:29, summer is right around the corner. Lake Living TN is releasing a limited number of lake lots to the public. Dan Mandis here. And one day only, April 20th, you can come check out our exclusive properties and experience lake living at a fraction of the cost. A couple of examples. 2-acre wooded estate lots at Lake Living TN, they are starting at just $79,900. Lake cottage packages with a boat slip, they're starting at just $349,900. Now, the amenities at Lake Living TN, they are incredible. From a brand new marina to 3.5 miles of shoreline, pickleball courts, swimming pools, coffee shops, and restaurants, Lake Living TN is the perfect place for vacation homes and retirees. Just over 20 minutes from Knoxville and a short drive to the Smoky Mountains. Enjoy life on the water. Call to secure your private tour right now. Times are limited. That is coming up again this Saturday, April 20th. LakeLivingTN.com is the website. Check it out. LakeLivingTN.com. Better yet, call them. Tell them Dan told you to reach out. 865-408-9992. 865-408-9992.
6:30 on the dot. I'm Ken Weaver with your top stories. We are still under risk of severe weather. Full forecast, traffic updates in 5 minutes. Right now, traffic is the top story. Part of 840 East in Williamson County is going to be shut down for months to repair damage to a bridge in Thompson Station. At least one lane of the interstate will be open there at 840, but drivers are still asked to take the exit 23 detour. And if you have to be in Chattanooga today, you might want to map out an alternate route. 24 has been shut down in both directions at Mont Eagle due to a crash. Looks like they're trying to get people around it, but it's still very slow going there. Later today in Nashville, a judge hears more arguments in the Covenant School Shooters writings case. During yesterday's proceedings, Metro Attorney Laura Fox agreed some could be released to the public without compromising the investigation she says police are still conducting.
In fact, some of those redactions could be removed because now the folks have been interviewed. But I would defer to the police on who they've interviewed.
Well, the judge is expected to issue a written decision in the next 2 weeks. And money news, not the kind you want to hear, especially if you're trying to buy or sell a home.
President Biden touting his economic record while campaigning in Scranton, Pennsylvania Tuesday. At the same time, the Federal Reserve chair signaled stubborn inflation will likely delay any interest rate drops until later this year.
The recent data have clearly not given us greater confidence.
Especially when it comes to the labor and housing markets. High mortgage rates and low inventory are keeping many wannabe homeowners on the sidelines, especially in Boston, where the Boston Globe reports the median price for a single-family home in March reached a record $900,000.
Tennessee Congressman Mark Green has given the U.S. Senate articles of impeachment against Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas over the illegal immigration crisis at the southern border.
Throughout his tenure as Secretary of Homeland Security, Alejandro N. Mayorkas has repeatedly violated laws enacted by Congress regarding immigration and border security.
Congressman Green joins us live at 8:05 this morning. That's the latest news. Traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Thank you, Ken. Appreciate it. 6:32, Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. I want to tell you about my friends at Zero Res. Spring cleaning time in the Mandis house and maybe your house as well. Time to call Zero Res, and they've got a great offer going on right now. Three rooms of carpets cleaned for just $109, plus you're going to get a free hallway. That is over $70 in savings, plus you're going to get a free dryer vent cleaning with air duct cleaning as well. And if you've got some tile that also needs attention, you're going to get that 20% off. Now, this is the company that comes to my rescue. You know, the stuff that lives in your carpet, right? Pet germs, odors, things that make you and your kids sick. Well, Zero Res can get most of that junk out of your carpet, leaving you with soft, fluffy carpets that are going to dry twice as fast. And by the way, one of the things I really like about Zero Res, one of many things I like about Zero Res, they don't use any harsh chemicals. That means pure safety for your pets and family. And don't forget that great deal. Three rooms of carpets cleaned for just $109. Plus, you're going to get a free hallway. That is over $70 in savings and a whole lot more. Call them today. Tell them Dan told you to reach out. 615-535-9376. 615-535-9376. Book online, ZeroResNashville.com. Zero Res, it is the right way to clean. Six 36 on WTN. Friends, if you're researching new generators, you've got to call my friend Generator Dave at Cove Generators. Now, not only are they the best generator company in Middle Tennessee, but to prove it, a great new deal just for listeners to my show. Right now, they're offering you a free, upgraded 7-year warranty now through May 12th, plus $500 off when you buy any Generac home standby generator. That means you can be prepared for the next power outage with my friends at Cove Generators. They are your official Generac home standby generator dealer in Tennessee. Call them right now. Tell them Dan told you to reach out and get that great warranty and that $500 off. 931-559-3311. 931-559-3311. And again, don't forget that great deal. You mention me at WTN, you're going to get that $500 off plus that free upgraded 7-year warranty protect you and your family. When the power goes out, your new purchase from Cove Generator will turn the power right back on and protect your family. CoveGenerators.com, 931-559-3311. Nashville's morning news on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. CNN calls this a developing story. They're saying that it is clear that the Israelis have made a decision to act against Iran. And so that is a story that we'll continue to follow for you throughout the day here on Nashville's morning news. We are live and local, 5A7P at 99.7 WTN. The Members Nutrition Super Text line is open, 615-737-9986, and you can follow me at Dan Mandis Show on Twitter. And I want to play you a piece of audio, but it doesn't do it justice. I've seen a lot of horrific things in my day. I've been doing talk radio a long time, but I want you to go check out the video at Dan Mandis Show on Twitter. It is the story, it is the video of a teacher in North Carolina that is getting brutalized by one of her students.
One more time.
Oh!
Do you think that affected me any?
Let me hit you again. Let me hit you again.
Yep, there you go. Guy walks up to the teacher. Now, the teacher, middle-aged woman, and she is sitting in a chair. So she's sitting down, and this student is clearly, I mean, being violent against her. The video starts with, and I played you all that I could of the video. The video starts with the student standing in front of the teacher, and then just clocks her across the head. I mean, you heard it.
One more time.
Oh!
You hear that? That is the sound of this guy's fist cracking this teacher aside the head.
More time.
Oh! I mean, that is awful. And this teacher got hit not once, but twice. Check out the video at Dan Mandis Show. It went viral yesterday. And again, this is in North Carolina. Now, that second blow sends this teacher's glasses flying from her head and leaves her brushing the hair out of her face as the attacker, as the story goes, glowers at her, standing over her. You want it again? And she said, as I played you the audio, I don't want it again. And then what did he do? He hit her again. And then he started mocking her. And so now, of course, teachers, and this is from a number of different news sources, teachers at a school have reacted with horror to a video of their middle-aged female colleague being repeatedly punched in the face and abused by a male student. The teenager has been arrested. Oh, but wait, there's more. The teenager has been arrested after a classmate filmed the profanity-laden physical attack at Parkland High School in North Salem, North Carolina. The teacher sits motionless in the classroom as the student lands a right-handed punch to her cheek before he steps back and demands, "Want me to hit you again?" If you haven't seen the video, millions of people have. It's awful. This happened, I guess, earlier this week. Now, the local district attorney Jim O'Neill said that he had no authority to prosecute this guy as an adult for his assault on the teacher. You know, they charged this guy with a misdemeanor. Yeah, a couple of misdemeanors. I'm going to play this for you again.
One more time.
Oh!
Do you think that affected me any?
Let me hit you again.
I don't want it.
Let me hit you again.
There you go. He said, I'm not playing with you. And he calling her all kinds of names as well, of course. A secure custody order was issued against the boy on Tuesday for one count of communicating threats and two counts of misdemeanor assault. And I'm sitting here thinking, okay, so how is this not a felony? And listen, trust me when I say, clearly, I'm no attorney. But I know how to use Google. Assault is the act of threatening to attack another person with a weapon that could cause them serious harm. Assault can be charged as a felony when the risk of harm, the attempted harm, or the actual harm increases or when other aggravating circumstances exist. So that was one of my questions, is why in the world, how in the world do you not charge this kid, number one, and I don't know how old he is, but how do you not charge him with a felony? Now, the DA, Jim O'Neill, says he just couldn't. Okay, I'm not entirely certain why, because this guy is using his fists to beat up a teacher. But it was his comments. It was this DA's comments that I found actually kind of comical. And I've got those for you coming up next on Nashville's Morning News at 6:45. Time to check the roads on Super Talk 99.7. Thank you, Jack. A scattered thunderstorms this morning. Cloudy this afternoon, a high of 80. Right now, 69 degrees at Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Everybody wants to know on the Super Text line, the student is black, the teacher is white. And so that adds, of course, to that dynamic. This teacher could do nothing to defend herself. And then you've got an entire classroom full of degenerate kids, in my opinion, who are egging this kid on, that's beating up this teacher, that is using his hands to pummel the teacher's head, not once, but twice. And so the DA, Jim O'Neill, said this kid could not be charged as an adult because the charges only amount to a misdemeanor, so they cannot be fought or brought to superior court. So this kid, effectively, in my opinion, is probably going to get away with this. I thought this was funny because this is what he is quoted as saying. We want to remind people, if you put your hands on a teacher, it's the same as if you put your hands on one of these officers. The district attorney's office will bring the weight of this office down on top of you, so you should have fear of consequences. Okay, well, a couple of misdemeanors, and he won't be charged as an adult. So this kid effectively is going to get away with it. They'll probably expel him. They haven't figured out what they're going to do with him yet. But I don't think this kid necessarily wants to be in school anyway. But I just thought it was really funny. We want to remind people, if you put your hands on a teacher, it's the same as if you put your hands on one of these officers. The DA's office will bring the weight of this office down on top of you, so you should have fear of consequences. Again, he was only charged with a misdemeanor. By the way, I also thought this was funny. Other district officials are talking, and they are equally as horrified. Listen to this.
Superintendent Tricia McManus says this behavior is not tolerated.
Should never happen on a campus in Winston-Salem Forsyth County Schools.
All right, so it should never happen, and it won't be tolerated. That's what the district person says. The school district recorded 46 incidents of students assaulting school staff in the last academic year.
Superintendent Tricia McManus says this behavior is not tolerated.
Should never happen on a campus in Winston-Salem Forsyth County Schools.
School district recorded 46 incidents of students assaulting school staff in the last academic year. So I think it's clear that you have the district attorney saying that you put your hands on a teacher, the entire weight of the DA's office is going to come down on top of you. So you should have fear of consequences of a misdemeanor. And again, district officials talking tough, saying it won't be tolerated except for the 46 previous times that it has happened this school year. And so they go on then to speak to a former teacher in the district, and I believe at the school. She says, I didn't fear the students. I didn't ever feel threatened by them in any way. And I really enjoyed my time teaching there, says Keisha Wall Freeman, who taught at the school between 2012 and 2019. But she said worsening behavior had been exacerbated by more lenient discipline. Remember back when Obama said that he wanted to end the school to jail pipeline? I mean, I covered that at the time, and I was horrified because I knew exactly what that would mean. It would mean that kids were not going to be disciplined. If you remember way back when, Barack Obama had this Dear Colleague letter basically saying that he didn't want to see this pipeline from schools to jail continue. And part of what they said, part of what the Democrats said, is that students, particularly students of color, minority students, and all that kind of stuff, were being unfairly disciplined and unfairly targeted. And that meant that this pipeline from schools to jail, it was exacerbated because of all of the unfairness that was happening inside the schools. Well, I guess my question would be this. This is now what this is leading to. A student beating the crap out of a teacher and only being charged with a misdemeanor. And this teacher is saying the worsening behavior had been exacerbated by more lenient discipline, courtesy of Barack Obama and the Democrats. They say that this woman continues to say they hear the cussing and the bad language from their parents as well. She says, I have seen that get progressively worse, even just going through the stores or in the malls. I hear it. I see it. And it wasn't like that not even 10 years ago. It wasn't like that. School principal Noel Keener telling parents the students will face disciplinary action over what she described as an inappropriate and unsettling interaction. But Jenny Easter of the Forsyth County Association of Educators describes the response to the attack as a travesty. She says the level of disrespect towards educators, to be frank, is one of many reasons. We are having a major teacher exodus crisis in the state. So, friends, if you haven't seen the video, it was all over social media yesterday. I just played you the audio. Go see the video, and you will see why I have such an absolute respect and appreciation for teachers, because they have to go through a lot, and this is yet another example. We'll have to see what happens to this kid. It's absolutely horrific. It's 6:51 on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. The Members Nutrition Super Text line is open, 615-737-9986. You know, our homes all have one thing in common. There's always that one spot where the Wi-Fi simply cannot reach. Now, for you, maybe it's the attic. Others, perhaps it is the basement. Well, if you had wall-to-wall Wi-Fi from Xfinity, you could worry less about those dead spots and just relax and have fun or work on your devices. With wall-to-wall Wi-Fi from Xfinity, You get fast speeds throughout your home, reliable connections in every room, and power for all your devices, even when everyone is online, like in my house. That's wall-to-wall Wi-Fi only on the Xfinity 10G network. Get wall-to-wall Wi-Fi from Xfinity for a reliable connection throughout your home. Now through April 21st, get gig speed internet for $35 a month for 12 months when you add unlimited mobile. Plus, get Wi-Fi equipment included for 2 full years. Go to Xfinity.com, call 1-800-XFINITY, or visit a store today and switch today. Requires paperless billing and auto pay with stored bank account. Restrictions apply, taxes and fees extra and may change. Gig speed Wi-Fi requires gig internet and Xfinity Gateway. After 12 months, internet increases to $60. After 24 months, regular rates apply. Xfinity Mobile requires Xfinity internet. Actual speeds vary. Six 54 Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7. Ken Weaver, what's coming up in the news?
Drivers in Williamson County face a longer commute. We've learned more about whether the Covenant school shooter's writing should be released to the public, and we're hearing from the fiance of one of the victims from that deadly road rage shooting in Murfreesboro. All this and more at 7 on Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
The guaranteed offer is the easiest way to sell your home. It's really simple. We bring you an all-cash offer. You close in as little as 21 days. No home inspections, no lock boxes, no open houses. Go to markspain.com to get a guaranteed offer and start packing.
7 o'clock on the dot this Wednesday morning. I'm Ken Weaver with your top stories. Still under threat of severe weather. Got the full forecast in 5 minutes. Also, drivers in Williamson County, you face a longer commute now that part of 840 East will be closed for months to repair damage to a bridge at Thompson Station. At least one lane of the interstate will be open there, but drivers still have to take the exit 23 detour. In about an hour and a half east of Nashville on 24, it's going to be slow go for eastbound because of a crash that has closed the northbound lanes at Mont Eagle. That's closed from Mont Eagle all the way up to the Pelham exit there at Highway 50. That's because of a multi-vehicle crash. But again, 24 eastbound is still open there, but it's slow. So if you've got plans in Chattanooga today, you still might want to map out a different route. Later today in Nashville, a judge hears more arguments in the Covenant School Shooter's writings case. Yesterday, a Metro attorney said part of the manifesto can be unredacted and released, but not until police are finished investigating whether anyone other than the shooter was involved, and that could take until July. Meanwhile, Peter Klett, attorney for Covenant School, argued those materials should never be released.
In this case, Your Honor, the motivation of the school and the interveners is simply to promote school safety. It is simply to keep our children, our staff, and our employees safe.
The judge could issue a written decision in the next 2 weeks. Governor Lee's plan to give parents up to $7,000 to send their kids to private schools is stalled, but money for it has been approved. The Tennessean says finance committees in both the House and Senate passed versions of the state budget that includes $144 million to initiate a voucher program, whether or not legislation passes. But there's no indication the Senate and House are going to make a deal in time to do it this year. And we're hearing from the fiance of one of the victims from a deadly road rage shooting in Murfreesboro. She tells Channel 4 she was riding on one of the motorcycles driven by 49-year-old Paul Powell, whom she says was shot after pulling over in the median and telling her to stay with the bike.
I couldn't save him. I tried stopping it. I tried so hard. The only thing that I could do is please hang on, baby. And he literally tried to spit out, I love you too, but you could see it in his eyes. You could see that he knew what I was saying. I go to sleep at night trying to think of all the good memories and not that memory, but it just wakes me up all the time.
Police say the driver of an SUV, 49-year-old Joseph Gann, turned himself in. Interest rate cuts, don't hold your breath. The nation's central bank may not cut rates as soon as it seemed it would just months ago, and now there's near confirmation from the Fed Chair Jerome Powell.
The recent data have clearly not given us greater confidence and instead indicate that it's likely to take longer than expected to achieve that confidence.
It means we're all but certain to see no change in rates in the next Fed announcement on May 1st, and now analysts aren't expecting a June cut either. Market Numbers Report brought to you by Beacon Capital Management, online at beaconcm.com. Dow futures up 102, S&P 16, NASDAQ 34. That's the latest news. Traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Matt Murphy for Members Nutrition. I want to tell you about the Members Nutrition difference, and I want to encourage you to go over to the Members Nutrition website. Number one, they believe at Members Nutrition that they can sell vitamins and supplements at a lower cost point, and they're doing it every single day at membersnutrition.com. Number two, they want to make these products right here in the United States of America, not from some overseas company, and they do that every single day. I encourage you to go to membersnutrition.com. You'll get 50% off your purchase price at checkout. You don't have to put in any codes. Just go to membersnutrition.com. Once again, membersnutrition.com.
Morning News with Dan Mandis.
And so, my fellow Americans,
we talk news. Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
708 Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN, along with Ken Weaver, Johnny B. I'm Dan Mandis. You know, it's really interesting, and I don't want to go back too far, but I just did that story, and on the student hitting the teacher in North Carolina. And it was crazy, the reaction on the super text line as it was coming in. And I think it brings up a couple of different points. But first, let me just reset this very quickly. And then I'm going to bring up the points that people are making about this teacher who is literally beating up a student. A teacher is being beaten up by a student in North Carolina.
One more time.
Oh! Oh!
What? You think that affected me any?
Let me hit you again. Let me hit you again.
I don't want it.
You want me to hit you again?
I don't want it.
You want me to hit you again?
My God.
That is a teacher being basically beaten up by a student in North Carolina. You can see the video on the Dan Mandis Show Twitter feed. But here's the thing. Without going through all of the other parts of the story that I was discussing, two very different but also very intriguing reactions from the super text line. Some people say this is exactly why teachers should be allowed to be armed. And others are saying this is actually why teachers should not be allowed to be armed. Isn't that interesting? Because I'm sitting here, hey, Johnny, do me a favor, JB. Can you take the phones off hold? I'm going to actually try to take calls on this. This is an audible. Omaha, Omaha. So I want to know where you stand on this. You have a teacher being beaten up by a student, female, middle-aged teacher, being smacked in the head twice by this student. Some of you have been saying this is why teachers should be allowed to be armed. Others saying this is exactly why a teacher should not be allowed to be armed. I want to know, which one are you when you put it in this particular point of reference, frame of reference? 615-737-9986. I'm actually taking calls on this because I got done with that segment and I saw all of the things that people were saying about this. And I think people have really good things to say about this. And so I'm going to go to Marie, and while Johnny banks those calls, I'm going to talk to Marie first on WTN. Marie, what do you think about that?
Dan, I love your show. My opinion is I do feel for the teachers, but however, I feel for the students also, because through the years, I have witnessed some of the most cruel teachers, from verbal abuse, physical abuse against children. And I'm not justifying that anybody should ever put their hands on anybody. A teacher should never put their hands on a child, and children never put their hands on their teacher. However, I have witnessed and been in schools and heard from my children, my own children, of teachers literally saying, you're the reason I hate my life. You're the reason that I don't want to be a teacher anymore. I've witnessed verbal abuse and abuse from teachers to students also. So this does go both ways. I'm not justifying it, but no, I do not think that teachers need to be armed. If somebody loses it for a few minutes, and somebody shot over it in a moment of, you know, rage, and a right. teacher, just as a student, equally can be dangerous.
You so know, Marie, I would ask, and I understand that. Let me ask you this question, though. What about a teacher being able to defend herself? Because this kid is, I mean, blows to the head twice. And I know what you're saying, which is, okay, but that's not worth taking another person's life, and I do understand that. But we've seen instances in other places where teachers are thrown to the ground and just many, many dozens of blows to the head by some of these students. And so I understand. I don't want to see, and by the way, just so folks are clear, I don't want to see, I do want to see teachers allowed to be armed. I am for that. I believe that teachers should be allowed to be armed because teachers are ultimately there to protect the kids and teach them as well. But I just think that, at least for me, teachers need to be able to defend themselves, even if it is against another student. When you look at this kind of a situation, Marie, what if the student, or what if the teacher got up? What let's say it was a female teacher who actually knew karate or jujitsu or something to that effect and got up and kicked the living crap out of this guy. I mean, is that teacher in the right to be able to defend herself against this guy?
I believe she is. I believe anybody has the right to defend themselves, but not with a deadly weapon. I really feel that this is where we have to have legislation. We have to work harder on getting SRO officers. And if it's a larger school, then we need, you know, two or three in there. This country has plenty of money.
Well, and Marie, I appreciate that. Got to run. Got a lot of other people want to talk about this, but I appreciate it. Jason is in Nashville on WTN. Jason, go ahead.
Yes, this is me. I'm from Smyrna.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. I believe that teachers should be armed with tasers or other non-lethal means to protect themselves. In this particular instance, especially as you know, this was not a use-a-gun type offense.
Right.
However, if she had a taser, she should have lit him up. I've seen the video, and, you know, it's completely, that student was completely in the wrong and off his rocker. I think teachers should be allowed to have tasers and other non-lethal means.
Jason, let me ask you this question. So then you're of the opinion that teachers shouldn't have guns either way. So this story doesn't, you know, one way or the other, this story doesn't change your mind or...
It does not. I believe that schools should be required to have armed personnel in the school at all times. Whether if the guy's on vacation, some other armed personnel should be there. But to give a gun to a teacher and expect them a law enforcement type person plus be a teacher, both of those jobs are hard enough as they are.
Yeah, Jason, I appreciate it. Got to run. A lot of people want to comment on this. 7:16. Time to check the roads from Super Talk 99.7. Thank you very much. As far as your weather goes, scattered thunderstorms this morning, cloudy this afternoon. High of 80 degrees, 69 now at Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Taking your calls on this situation in North Carolina where this student beat up a teacher.
One more time.
Oh!
You think that affected me any?
Let me hit you again.
I don't want it.
You want me to hit you again?
I don't want it.
Oh, my God. Yeah, you can see the video on my Twitter feed at Dan Mandis Show. And when I talked about this earlier, people said this is exactly why teachers should be allowed to carry. Other people said this is exactly why teachers should not be allowed to carry. Want to say hello to David in, I think in Nashville, perhaps, on WTN. David, how are you?
Good, sir. How are you?
Two thumbs up. Go ahead.
Hey, my wife is a behavioral specialist and a teacher, and so this is something that really hits home with us. I'll tell you right now, she is absolutely scared because some teachers just cannot handle the responsibility of having a gun. And a teacher's job is extremely stressful. Now imagine giving that teacher a loaded weapon like that. It's just, it's a recipe for disaster. And again, think about it like this. Even if that woman had a taser, had a weapon, there's nothing that says that that kid couldn't have gotten it away from her.
Right.
You know, we see these things all the time. One suggestion would be to put all of the teachers through the type of training my wife goes through as a behavioral specialist. She's trained to be able to take down a kid. She's trained with, you know, being able to take them down without hurting them. You know, there are.
You know what's so funny, David? Here, can I tell you something?
Yes, sir.
This woman is a middle-aged woman. I'm not casting any aspersions on middle-aged women, but it's a middle-aged woman. Yep. And you just said, and it triggered me a little bit, I'm not mad at you, but what you said was that teachers are being trained or need to be trained or whatever it was to be able to take a student down without hurting them. Can I tell you something?
Yeah.
I could give a rat's ass if this kid who's beating up this teacher gets hurt.
I
could care less if he gets hurt. He needs to be in prison for a long time for assault, because that's what that was. That's the problem. I'm not mad at you, David. That's the problem with the mentality of some of these idiots on the left, is you're coddling these kids, and that coddling is what leads to this kind of behavior.
No, it's legal. It's a legal issue. That's what brings it.
You know, David, I appreciate it. It's a parenting issue. It is a parenting issue. It is a societal issue. It is a political issue, because this kind of behavior is brought to you by the soft on crime Democrats. That's number one. Number two, you have parents who simply do not care. And it's a societal issue, because there's a good number of people in our society who just excuse this kind of abhorrent behavior. But David, thank you for the call. I'm not mad at you. Andrew is on the line. Hey, Andrew, go ahead.
Hey, how you doing? Thanks for taking my call.
Yep.
Okay, so let's move this situation to outside a grocery store, and a woman, middle-aged woman, is putting her groceries in a car, and she's attacked by that same kid who hits her twice. She'd be fully justified in shooting him.
If she feels like her life is in danger.
In that moment, there is no way she could not have believed she was in immediate threat of physical, of bodily harm. That is what you need to defend yourself with lethal force. If you're in the right, and she was, unless there's something more to the video that we haven't seen,
right,
there is no reason why teachers should not be allowed to carry. It's not arming teachers, it's allowing. And this teacher, there's no reason her or any other teacher who we trust with our children anyway should not be allowed to exercise their Second Amendment rights in the classroom concealed. Okay, and people talk about tasers. You can't carry around a taser without somebody seeing it. They're huge. You can carry around a little 380 and nobody would see it.
Yeah.
As far as resource officers, unless the resource officer was right there in that room or immediately in the hallway, nothing could have stopped that incident from happening with that student. If this kid doesn't go to jail for this incident, he will be in jail sometime in the future, because he has no respect for law, no respect for authority. This kid is going to end up in jail sooner or later, unless something huge changes in his life. And it's
all right, Andrew, thank you very much for the call. I appreciate it. Agree with you. I want to get to Mike very quickly in Atlanta on WTN. Go ahead, line 2.
Good morning.
Hey, Mike, go ahead.
Hey, so I've been a National Rifle Association firearms instructor for 20 plus years, of martial arts instructor in two different arts. And we removed my second oldest daughter from public school down here because, well, she was accosted by a young man who had missed a few grades. He had failed a grade or two. He had 100 pounds on her and 6 inches as far as height. He put his hand on her chest and shoved her up against the wall, was, you know, oh, baby, why don't you be with me kind of thing. And, well, thankfully she dropped the pencils that she had in her hand. But she did a palm strike to his nose, punched him in the throat, put her hands, grabbed his shirt at the tips of his shoulders on each side, and then she put all of her weight on his knee and broke his right knee to the outside.
I love
taught
that.
I taught my daughter that you're a female. You can't stand toe-to-toe with a man for more than a few seconds. You have to hurt them really bad so that they can't pursue you once they recover from your initial attack.
And Mike, the last thing I would say, I didn't hear you say a knee to the groin. That also works. And I appreciate the call. Thank you very much. I'm way late, Anthony, but go ahead. You got 30 seconds. Please go.
Hey, Dan. First point people are missing is that it's completely a choice, but I am all for teachers being able to carry. Right. This may not have warranted a shooting per se, but I would say that it would definitely deter the behavior, and that's what I got for that one.
All right, Anthony, thank you very much. I appreciate it. 7:23 on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Busy Bee Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling. You know, when it comes to your home, maintenance is key, especially that HVAC unit, which is why I am a Beehive member from my friends at Busy Bee Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling. Now, that ensures that I'm going to be running at peak efficiency for maximum comfort is that maintenance. Now, what they're going to do when you sign up to be a Beehive member is they're going to text you every time it's time for that maintenance. And when you get that maintenance, that means that you are running at peak efficiency for maximum comfort. As Beehive members, you also get 3 maintenance services a year, including plumbing, plus 10% off of all repairs, front-of-the-line service, and no overtime or holiday fees. Check them out today. They are your Rude Pro Partner, Busy Bee Plumbing, Heating, and Cooling, 615-775-7833, 615-775-7833, BusyBeeHVAC.com. Ken Weaver, what's coming up in the news?
Well, heads up for drivers in Williamson County. You got longer commutes for about 3 months. More marching and chanting in downtown Nashville today over some legislation these folks don't think is right. Another day of hearings on the Covenant school shooter writings and bad news if you're in a hurry to buy or sell a home. All this and more at 7:30 on Supertalk 99.7 WTN.
Thank you, Ken. 7:25, Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Okay, coming up next, you don't want to miss this. You know that the governor's voucher program, freedom vouchers, whatever you want to call them, it looks like there is a big-time impasse within the state legislature. The House, as you know, threw a whole bunch of stuff into the legislation. The Senate's version was, I would say, cleaner, and the governor basically said, here's what I want. Figure out a way to make it happen. I'm very much simplifying that. But Cameron Smith from the Tennessee, and he fills in here on WTN as well. He is going to join us at 7:36 to give us the very latest on Governor Lee's school voucher program. That is straight ahead on WTN. 729, Nashville's Morning News on WTN. You think about all that can go wrong with your home. There's one company in Middle Tennessee and southern and western Kentucky that tens of thousands of people have trusted to repair those issues. United Structural Systems. I'm Dan Mandison. They've been out to my house a couple of times. Now, all the rain that we just seem to be getting, you might end up with some water, some moisture down in your basement or crawl space. You need some waterproofing, and USS, they are the absolute experts in waterproofing. Now, if you have maybe some foundation issues, some concrete issues, they can fix all of that and a whole lot more. What I'd like you to do is go to their website, USSTN.com, and you'll find all the services that they provide. You can also call them, by the way, at 615-488-7855. Homeowners Trust USS. They offer lifetime guarantees on their work, and they've got hundreds of five-star reviews. Homeowners do trust USS, and there's a great reason why, because they do great work and provide outstanding customer service. USSTN.com. Tell them Dan Mandis told you to reach out at 615-488-7855.
On the dot. I'm Ken Weaver with your top stories. We are still at risk of severe weather. Full forecast and traffic in 5 minutes. And speaking of traffic, heads up, drivers in Williamson County, part of 840 East will be down to one lane for months while repairs are made to an overpass in Thompson Station. Drivers are being asked to take the exit 23 detour to Carter's Creek Pike, even though one lane of 840 will be open. And allow yourself some time, more time that is, if you've got to go to Chattanooga this morning. There is a crash that has both directions of 24 down to one lane in Mont Eagle. That's about an hour and a half away. Later today in Nashville, Channel 4's Jordan James says there will be more marching with signs and chanting by groups opposed to legislation like school vouchers and arming teachers and school staff.
More than 20 organizations from across the state will be marching through downtown and making their way towards Legislative Plaza to address issues considered by them to be harmful.
Yeah, look for all that to happen around 3 o'clock today. And this morning in Nashville marks another day of hearings over the Covenant school shooters' writings and whether they should be released to the public. Yesterday, Metro attorney Laura Fox told the judge the city has no problem releasing a redacted version of the manifesto, but not until police wrap up investigating whether anyone else was involved.
In fact, some of those redactions could be removed because now the folks have been interviewed. But I would defer to the police on who they've interviewed.
That may not happen until July. Money news and not the kind you want to hear, especially if you're wanting to buy or sell a home.
President Biden touting his economic record while campaigning in Scranton, Pennsylvania Tuesday. At the same time, the Federal Reserve chair signaled stubborn inflation will likely delay any interest rate drops until later this year.
The recent data have clearly not given us greater confidence.
Especially when it comes to the labor and housing markets. High mortgage rates and low inventory are keeping many wannabe homeowners on the sidelines, especially in Boston, where the Boston Globe reports the median price for a single-family home in March reached a record $900,000.
That is the latest news, traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Thank you, Ken. 733, Nashville's Morning News. Listen, opening up your home to showings means that strangers can, frankly, open anything in your home. With Mark Spain Real Estate, you don't have to worry about getting around to spring cleaning and sell your home with the guaranteed offer. And you can skip the cleaning and organizing necessary to sell your home when you call Mark Spain Real Estate. You can say goodbye to the stress that comes with a traditional home sale. With the guaranteed offer from Mark Spain Real Estate, you can receive an all-cash offer and close within days. There's no showings, no open houses, and no costly repairs. Mark Spain Real Estate makes selling your home stress-free. They've got over 11,000 five-star reviews. Mark Spain Real Estate is the most trusted and experienced real estate team in America. So spring into action and sell your home with confidence with Mark Spain Real Estate. Call them, tell them Dan told you to reach out. 855-299-SOLD, 855-299-SOLD. Go to markspain.com to find out what your guaranteed offer will be. There's no obligation. That's markspain.com to get a guaranteed offer and start packing. 7:38, Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Good morning to your friends, along with Johnny B., Ken Weaver, Dan Mandis here. And it looks like Governor Bill Lee's school voucher program, the Education Freedom Scholarship Act, it's in trouble. Want to welcome on into the program. You've heard him on WTN filling in, guest hosting, and of course you read him in the Tennessean and many other newspapers across the state. And also, of course, with our friend Matt Murphy at noon to 3. Cameron Smith is joining us. Cameron, how are you?
I'm doing great, Dan.
Thank you, Cameron. So let's talk about what is going on with Governor Lee's Education Freedom Scholarship Act. A lot of people are saying that it's dead. A lot of people are saying, or at the very least, that it's on life support. We are clearly at an impasse. The big issue here, it seems to me, is that the House and the Senate, they're far apart on some pretty major issues. The House plan had a lot of extra stuff thrown in there that the Senate can't agree to. Let's talk about the biggest differences between the two versions.
Sure. And I've got a piece forthcoming on this that I read both versions of the bills. I've talked to legislators. I think dead-ish is the right area, because you're truly correct that there is an impasse between House and Senate Republicans. The easiest way to sum it up is to quote the Tennessee Education Association, which opposes the voucher measure. They've said, and this is President Tanya Coates, in an attempt to win support for a bad bill, the voucher expansion legislation has been packed with concepts to improve public education for which the TEA has advocated for many years. So what's happening here is the TEA, which is not exactly a conservative-friendly organization, they're very much like the NEA, advocates of the status quo in public education. In order to get Republicans to vote to empower parents, Republicans in the House are having to give up TEA priorities. That tells me we have maybe the wrong Republicans in the House of Representatives on educational issues.
So, yeah, it sounds like ultimately what they're trying to do is pack a bunch of, I don't know, would you call that, would you call this like pork kind of a thing, where it's like, okay, we're going to throw it up, whole bunch of stuff in there to try and get the lawmakers to vote for it, but it strays far from what they originally wanted, which is basically to give a parent school choice.
Yes, Dan, there are about 40 titles and 20 extra legislative pages dedicated to things not related to a voucher program.
Okay.
I mean, we've got a complete rewrite of teacher evaluations. We've got guaranteed funding for health insurance for teachers. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff in here. There's even stuff here to loosen accountability for schools that are in trouble that would have to annually provide a plan. This legislation would push it back to every 3 years. So it's less accountability, more money, and it's not related to vouchers.
Can I ask a dumb question? Because you're a lot smarter than me on this stuff. So why would the House put all of this stuff in, knowing that it's got to pass muster with the Senate?
Well, these are poison pills, plain and simple. We can be as polite as we want to, but if you're looking to move a voucher bill, you just move the voucher bill. What this is folks saying, and I can tell you down to the detailed language, I had to go through and look up every individual code section to kind of figure out what they were talking about. But for example, they bump up the public school funding formula in sparse and small districts. What that tells me is that rural legislators are saying, well, this school choice thing, I don't think it would be bring back the goodies to my district, so you got to give me some money for my vote.
Right.
And again, if that's the way that we're going to negotiate in the House, and Cameron Sexton, the speaker, is saying, oh, this is acceptable, I strongly suggest that Governor Lee force the issue and say, hey, look, I'll tell you what, we'll pass this Senate version and we'll send it over to the House, and any House member that wants to vote against it is welcome to, but I'll spend the last 2 years of my term coming up with primary components for every last one of you.
There's also the issue of testing. We're going to talk about the primaries in a second, but let's also talk about the issue of testing. House Republicans want less testing. Senate Republicans want more testing. How big of a divide is there? And is this one of those 40 or so poison pills that you were talking about? And there's also the issue of homeschool families and private schools. They would have to give more standardized testing.
Yeah, if you want to be part of a government program, then you're probably going to have to submit to some testing. This is a point where the House and the Senate should just agree that the thing that we're tracking here is relative student progress. How a student progresses year over year, not where their absolute level is, because this is what detractors from vouchers and charter schools do, is they say, well, these underperforming students and these underperforming schools moved to a different school, and oh no, they didn't immediately do light years better. It's about relative student progress. So it should be about what we're measuring and what we're testing and when we're testing. I don't think that there's a way to expend public funds and say, well, we're not really going to have any information on the results. We just hope it works well. So I think it's finding an agreement where, okay, the same testing paradigm is there for everybody. And I'm a homeschool parent. We have a homeschool hybrid program. Mm-hmm. I would love to take up this program, but one, it only applies to private and public schools in the versions that I looked at. So a homeschool family could move to a private school, for example, but it wouldn't apply immediately to homeschooling. And if you want the money, you're probably going to have to, there's some strings attached. There always are with government, but I don't think it's the situation where the government's going to go in and impose testing on you if you don't take the money.
Speaking of the money, I want to talk to you about funding coming up next, because there's a lot of people that have different opinions about this money, where it's coming from. Is this a defunding of the public schools and all of that? I've got to check the roads. 7:45. Time to check the roads on Super Talk 99.7. Scattered thunderstorms this morning, cloudy this afternoon, a high of 80, 66 now at WTN. Cameron Smith is joining us from the Tennessee, and he does fill in around here as well. Generally speaking, a good guy. Cameron, always appreciate having you on WTN. Can we talk about the funding for Governor Lee's Education Freedom Scholarship Act? So $144 million, and so the way that I understood this is that this is going to be from a different bucket of money than the education budget. That's what we were told early on. We still heard the hue and the cry of we're defunding the public schools. Where do you stand on all of that?
I mean, these are taxpayer dollars. So at the end of the day, I mean, that's the way I look at it. When we see a budget and whether this budget has the vouchers in it, then we'll kind of know exactly which bucket, if you will, it's coming from. As far as me as a taxpayer looking at it, it's all public money.
Yep.
So the idea that there's a magical account for which we pay for education and there's other accounts, I just disagree with that interpretation. Again, the TEA and NEA have always said the right answer for public education is throw more money at it. And so they don't like anything that's seen as a alternative to a traditional public school. If it's not controlled by the local education authority, that they don't like that. And so when you look at the funding, what's in, like, the Senate bill, for example, is the base funding formula. The state's going to pay 100%. And then, for example, if a student transfers from public school to a different public school that they're not zoned for, it's a smaller amount, but it's based on either what that school charges for the move or what that student, you know, would get where they are. And so is this going to radically shift public education? Probably not. Over time, if it's successful, will it have an impact? Yeah, because you're moving kids. And what some of these schools and some of these particularly underperforming schools, the schools got accountability measures in the state of Tennessee. You can see the list of which schools are chronically underperforming. What these schools know is that if you take students out of those schools, if the parents and families who can leave do leave, that makes it even harder because you have less interested parents on the schools that are there. And so the state needs to be thinking about that and saying, if this is wildly successful, well, how are we going to address the chronic underperformance of schools where we still have kids and we've taken, given other people options to get out of it. I think those are fair questions to ask, but it's not a reason to give parents fewer options.
Can we talk about what happened in Arizona? A lot of people, I've monologued on it before, but I want to get your opinion on it. There's a lot of discussion about what happened in Arizona, where they also have a voucher program. There was some fraud. It went way over budget. There's a lot of people that are questioning the results as to whether or not the kids actually performed any better because of that program. Was Arizona an influence in how this legislation is being drafted or was drafted?
I think everybody's looking at Arizona and saying, uh-oh, we had some issues here. This is about accountability and paying attention. At the end of the day, the devil is in the details. And we like to talk in broad platitudes, but the specifics of how are you holding accountable? The reason I suggest emphasis on individual relative student performance is because I know that's what we're looking for and the problem we're trying to solve. And so fraud's always an issue because bad actors come out. This happens with charter schools. It happens with voucher programs. Folks say, well, you know what? I bet we could get some money if we started this school. Again, good oversight from the Department of Education, the ability to look at these schools and say, you know what? These expenses aren't legitimate. This isn't a real school. That kind of thing can address those problems, but that's a lot of work. And so if I'm a legislator right now in Tennessee, I'm going to the Department of Education and saying, if I'm going to vote for this, I got to know that we have accountability in place because there will be fraud. And are we going to catch it in time to make sure that funds that would be used to educate students are not funneled away to nefarious actors?
So we know that vouchers are already in play, Hamilton, Davidson, and Shelby counties. In your opinion, have those been successful? And did the performance there have any bearing on these current discussions?
Well, if you look at and I'll sort of broaden the category to school choice.
Okay.
If you look at school choice, you look at charter schools, you look at the voucher pilots and things like that, what you see is, frankly, mixed results. If I'm honest, that's kind of where it is. And I understand that people say, well, that's evidence that, well, we shouldn't give this stuff a shot because not everything has been uniformly successful across the board. My take on it is, well, are you counting public schools in this? Are you counting the underperformance of the existing public schools? Because the idea that, well, any alternative to a struggling, I'll say the word, failing school, chronically underperforming school, is the solution must be 100% successful, foolproof, and never have any issues. Well, that's an absolutely ridiculous comparison because the kids are in a failing school and they need an option. So if you're telling me the only option they can have is a perfect one, I'm going to fight you on that one.
You know, it's interesting, Cameron Smith joining us. When this whole thing came out, and you may disagree with me on this, but when the governor announced what he wanted to do, Education Freedom Scholarship Act, you know, one of the things that I said, and I was criticized by some, was, okay, so I think as conservatives, we all appreciate and support, you know, school choice. But I just didn't know if this was the right plan. And I mean, clearly, now that we know more details and the infighting within the Republican Party, I think it is clear that this is not the right plan, at least not what we have going on perhaps in the House. If you were to look at all sides, and you may not want to do this, but if you want to look at all sides, you've got the Senate, Governor Lee, the House, and you said it is your fault, this chamber, as to why this didn't pass, whose fault is it if it doesn't pass? Whose fault would it be?
Oh, there's plenty of blame to go around.
Okay.
I mean, I don't feel like the Republican leadership did a great job of getting the team players on the same page to begin with. The idea was just a basic voucher idea, and it was really flexible to start off with. I think we should have gone with, hey, here are the specifics, here's the accountability, here's the way it works. Let's run it through and vote, and then let the political process work. In fact, my piece, I hate to let the conclusion out of the bag, but it's, we should play hardball here, that put it out, let's see where the votes are, and then when folks disagree, you can primary them, you can go after them, and then we see, okay, where are we and who's really dedicated to this? I know people don't like that. People are very polite in Tennessee politics, but that's how this should work. The Senate, if they can get their bill out, should pass it. send it over to the House and say, hey, guys, why don't y'all vote on this? And if it fails, it fails. But the reality is Governor Lee, after these upcoming elections, is effectively going to be a lame duck. This is probably one of his last signature priorities. And I think getting something enacted or at least seeing how it fails gives you either the option to go play politics and fight it out there, or see if you can get the clean voucher bill passed.
Let me ask you, Cameron, wrapping this up, there's pressure from outside groups that are trying to get this passed. It doesn't at least look to me like it is going to, at least this session. Talking about State Rep Todd Warner, he is being attacked in his district for voting against keeping a promise to his small rural county constituents. So he said to them, I will not effectively, and I'm going to air quote here, defund the schools in our district, the public schools in our district. We don't have private schools to go to. And a lot of Republicans in small districts, that's what they were dealing with, is they just didn't have the additional private schools to send the kids to. And so now we have a situation where you have people like Todd Warner and others, I assume, who didn't want to vote for this because of this promise they made to their constituents. Now they're going to be primaried, and you're going to have some of these outside groups throwing in a whole bunch of money, so on and so forth. How big of a deal is this going to be in the next election?
Oh, it's going to be a big deal. I mean, I think that's where, if I were Governor Lee, that's what I'd go to, is I will personally help find primary opponents. I understand the argument of I don't have public schools around me, but what that or other private options around me. But that's the same argument the Democrats make, mm-hmm. that if we can't solve this for every student in the state of Tennessee, we shouldn't give any students and families more options. It's holding the idea hostage because, well, if we can't fix it, public education for everybody, then we can't fix it for anybody. That's a loser's mindset. And frankly, I would be right there helping find some primary opponents for those guys.
All right, Cameron, when is your piece going to be out in the Tennessean?
Well, I've got a couple things to finalize, but I'm going to drop it and file it this morning, so it should be out quickly.
All right, Cameron, always appreciate having you on the show, and have a great rest of day. 7:55 on WTN. Dan Mandis here. How would you like to be free of car loan debt, credit card debt, no personal loans? Loan Pronto can help you do just that with an Equity Express line of credit. Now, you can tap into that equity in your home today and save you money on those high-interest loans as well. Homeowners are turning that home equity into cash almost instantly these days with Loan Pronto's AI-based system. It takes about 10 minutes, and it is really easy with no documentation, no appraisal, and no hassle, just relief from those high interest rates. So call them right now to get started at 615-499-5780, 615-499-5780. You can find them online at loanpronto.com, equal housing lender, NMLS 166-1781, subject to lender approval. What an absolute mess. Hey, it's Dan Mandis, and look at my closets. Unorganized to say the least. Even my window dormer is a train wreck. Stuff is everywhere. Now, luckily, California Closets is coming to my rescue. My personal design consultant, Vince, stopped by, measured, and is now showing me how to become more space-efficient and organized on his 3D CAD system. It is amazing. And soon, my space is going to be organized, and yes, even Bandit approves. California Closets, a local company that can customize the storage in any room of your house. California Closets, what can they do for you? Find them online at californiaclosets.com and reach out for your free in-home consultation.
8 o'clock on the dot. I'm Ken Weaver with your top story. Still under threat of severe weather. Full forecast in 5 minutes. Part of I-840 East going to be closed in Williamson County for months to repair damage to a overpass at Thompson Station. At least one lane of the interstate will be open, but drivers are still asked to take the exit 23 detour. And if you have to be in Chattanooga today, you might want to map out an alternate route or at least allow extra time. 24 is down to one lane both directions due to a crash at Mont Eagle. More traffic in 5 minutes. Here in Nashville, more arguments scheduled in front of a judge on whether to release the Covenant school shooter's writings to the public. Here's Channel 4's Joylynn Bukovac.
Metro's lawyer argued that the court should not force them to hand anything over right now, but they could turn over a redacted version of the journal that was found in the shooter's car.
But that may not happen until July, when the Metro attorney said the police investigation into whether or not anyone else was involved could wrap up. The Chancery Court judge hearing the case expected to release a written decision within 2 weeks. Market numbers report brought to you by Beacon Capital Management, online at beaconcm.com. Dow futures up 18, S&P up 17, NASDAQ up 50. That's the latest news. Traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Morning News with Dan Mandis.
And so, my fellow Americans,
we talk news. Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
806 on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Welcome on into Nashville's Morning News. Dan Mandis here, along with Johnny B, Ken Weaver. And when I start my interview with Congressman Mark Green, chairman of the Congressional Committee on Homeland Security, with this audio from Senator John Kennedy. This was yesterday on the Senate floor.
Two charges in an impeachment of Secretary Mayorkas. And those are serious charges. They're as serious as four heart attacks and a stroke. The first one is willful and systemic refusal to comply with the law. Not negligence. Willful and systemic refusal to comply with the law. The second charge is breach of the public trust.
And Congressman Mark Green does join us on the Newsmaker Hotline. Congressman, thank you very much. Did you see the Senator Kennedy talking about your months-long work on these articles of impeachment with Alejandro Mayorkas? And what did you think about his full-throated support?
Well, I mean, obviously, getting the support of folks like the senator from Louisiana, or you know, Mike Lee, Ted Cruz. We did a press conference right after reading the articles with all those guys. They invited me in to be a part of their press conference, and you know, it obviously makes you one, aware of the gravity of what's gone on and the solemnness of the moment. You know, I basically got to walk into the Senate chamber, read from the well, the articles of impeachment yesterday, first time in the history of the country that's happened with a sitting cabinet secretary. You know, it's a pretty profound moment in history, the history of our country, and to be the guy leading that, I mean, it gave some satisfaction to accomplishing what I think had to happen, needed to happen for the country, but also just sadness that this is where the country is. So a lot of mixed emotions yesterday. And of course, Senator Kennedy was in that press conference, shared that same analogy, you know, serious as I think yesterday in the press conference, he said serious as an aneurysm. Obviously that's a euphemism he's used before, but it mixed emotions, and you know, I just hurt for our country and the people of America for what's happened in the southwest border.
Well, you know, one of the things that I spoke about earlier in the broadcast is I went through, you know, basically getting away from all the legalese, basically what you're saying and what you are stating, and it is, as far as I can tell, legally accurate, that what Alejandro Mayorkas and President Biden are engaged in is a mass catch and release program. And that does violate the laws. You know, the Democrats are out there saying, well, there's nothing to this, when in reality, the way that you lay this out, it is very specific immigration laws that they are accused of breaking. And it's all about detention and release. It's got to be frustrating for you to turn on the TV or listen to the Democrats and say, well, there's really no evidence that Alejandro Mayorkas is breaking any law, when in the legislation right down to the sentence, you talk about what laws they're breaking.
Yeah, so Mayorkas issued guidance to employees of DHS to ignore the law, laws passed by Congress, and by so doing, and sort of reinventing many systems to get around and to violate the Immigration and Nationality Act. And by so doing, he basically disrupts the entire foundation of the government. Everything for me goes back to the Constitution. You know, that's what my oath is to. And the Constitution is very clear that the founders wanted to divide power between three separate but equal branches of government. And, you know, you learn this in grade school. The Congress writes the laws. The executive branch executes those laws. And we've gotten away from that on so many levels with the bureaucracy. You know, the ATF's rule just recently coming out. I mean, it's like the executive branch writes and executes the laws now. But on this particular note, we wrote a law that said you shall detain felonies, and they are to be held until they're removed from the country. And he basically told his people to ignore that law. And you can't have the executive branch just picking which laws they're going to execute and choosing not to execute others. That's that tears at the foundation of the country. And if you have this rogue cabinet secretary out there doing whatever the heck he wants, I think that's a road to tyranny. I mean, the founders spread power out. They spread it out between three branches of government, not to put power in the hands of one individual. And we have, in this country, drifted for decades into concentration of power into the hands of fewer and fewer people, and that will lead to tyranny, has led to tyranny. And the ATF rule is tyranny. I mean, it's a violation of the Second Amendment. So this is just another example of that. And that's the real issue for me, Dan, is the Constitution. You know, we're violating the very form of government that our founders set up. And that's why I think it's a high crime. He's abused his position to force his immigration agenda onto the people of the country, when the people of the country voted on something different through their elected officials in the Congress. So that's why I think he has to go. I mean, and why I'm so passionate about it, despite knowing full well that Schumer probably will do nothing with it.
Yeah, I want to get to that. Let me ask you, Congressman Mark Green joining us. I interviewed you. I don't know if you remember, probably not. You do a lot of these. But I interviewed you actually the day that you started down this road of investigating the articles of impeachment. And now here we are again today, and I appreciate the opportunity. So let me ask you, from that first day to when you put the final period on the articles of impeachment, did anything surprise you as to how incredibly incompetent Alejandro Mayorkas is? And I know that we could argue over whether or not they're doing this on purpose or if they're truly incompetent. I'll ask you that in a second. But did anything surprise you in this process?
I think the biggest surprise was Mike Gallagher. You know, Mike and I have been friends in Congress. He's a bright mind. We will frequently just grab coffee and talk China policy or you know, transatlantic policy, NATO, things like that. He's a very bright mind, particularly on foreign affairs. I was very disappointed honestly, I think it was a part on his part fear that if we open this Pandora's box, every cabinet secretary we have in the next administration will get impeached. And I thought, you know, that's not a reason to not do this. Because it's the right thing to do it. So I think the biggest surprise was just, you know, him. And we had two Republicans vote against impeachment. And that probably bothered me more than anything in the process.
I'm just Googled. Mike Gallagher is hinting death threats, he says, may be behind his early resignation. This has become a story for, you know, not only obviously Washington, D.C., but I mean, every state now is a border state. Let me ask you, do you believe, Congressman Mark Green, do you believe that there's two schools of thought? Do you believe that he is doing this, Mayorkas and Biden and the Democrats, are they doing this on purpose for political reasons, for, you know, representation in some of these, you know, various cities across America? They get more in the House of Representatives, more representation? Or do you think this is just sheer incompetence? I'm going to let you cogitate on that. It's a busy day out on the roadway, so I'm going to check the traffic, then get your response to that next. It is Super Talk 99.7. Time to check those roads. It's 16 on Nashville's Morning News, and as far as your weather, scattered thunderstorms this morning, cloudy this afternoon, a high of 80. Congressman Mark Green is joining us. Earlier, I had Senator Bill Hagerty on, and he is of the opinion that the reason why Mayorkas and Biden want the wide open border, political reasons for representation in the House of Representatives, among other things. What say you, Congressman?
Yeah, I think that's their ultimate motivation. And if you look at what Mayorkas has done, it's been engineered. I mean, this was a system created, whether it was the use of the CBP One app or, you know, these cooperative agreements where they're flying, I think last year, 300 plus thousand from specific countries, giving them a special status through the immigration process, which Congress has not passed or authorized. I think it's all been engineered, and it's to get people, and they know most of these people will go to blue cities, and then that will alter the census data and result in more blue districts, you know, just naturally getting power in the House of Representatives. So I think that is their ultimate goal, and I agree with Senator Hagerty on that. I mean, you know, it's hard to see any other motivation. I think some people have speculated that it's on a grander scheme. They want to bring America down. And clearly in the Democrat Party, I mean, you can see the Palestinian protest, death to Israel, death to America. These are Democrat voters. And so there's a group of them out there that really just hate the country, and they'll do anything to see America brought low, because they view anyone that's successful, that you couldn't be successful, a nation couldn't be successful unless that nation cheated somehow or did something wrong. And that permeates a certain segment of the Democrat Party. So woke and DEI and all that stuff is designed to really bring people who are successful down. Its basis is in covetousness, but they also apply it to nations. And so there are people who suggest that as well.
You spoke earlier about how the head of the Senate, Chuck Schumer, more than likely will not take this up. Do you feel like then that all of your work was for naught?
So the probability is that he won't, because the Democrat Party cannot sustain politically this issue, right? I mean, it's an 80-20 issue in swing districts.
Well, they also can't defend it, but go ahead.
Right. They can't defend it, number one. They just name call me. I mean, if you listen to the ranking member, anytime he has an argument to make, it's just attack me, attack Trump, right? So they have no argument. That's right. They can't defend it. But they don't want this talked about either. So they would much rather hide the issue. To have a trial in the Senate will put every camera in the room talking about border security, and that's the last thing Joe Biden needs for his reelection attempts.
All right. So it's been a minute since you and I spoke. So a while back, you announced that you were going to retire, considering retiring. You changed your mind. Now here you are on this day where you have done massive amounts of work, and now it's probably not going to be taken up in the Senate. On this day, do you regret that decision to unretire? Are you glad you've unretired, or what's your mindset right now?
You know, I what probably makes me scratch my head on that one is this whole issue of taking the speaker down again. That whole debate and the disenfranchisement and frustration in our own party, it probably leads me more toward. I mean, I expected Chuck Schumer wouldn't do anything with the impeachment articles, and I pressed forward because I thought it was my duty. And I guess in the same vein, I'm running for reelection because I feel like it's my duty. And that was certainly communicated to me by Marsha and all the others that have called and said, to include President Trump, who said, look, we need you one more term. And so, you know, what do you say to that when the former president of the United States, hopefully soon to be president again, calls you and says, look, I need you to go through this election cycle. And I'm like, okay, sir.
Yeah. Like an offer you can't refuse.
I'm frustrated. I mean, the heart of your question is I'm frustrated. I'm frustrated with the difference between how Republicans govern and how Democrats govern. And I think we do it the right way, but the way they've done it, they've figured out how to clip our wings, and the strategy to get around that is bigger majorities. I mean, so because we're going to vote our districts, and Fitzpatrick's district is a Biden 9. He is going to vote differently than me if he's representing his district. And so when Republicans take the perspective of representative government, which is what the founders wanted, and then we go against a block of ideology, they don't vote their districts on the left.
Right.
So when you have a thin majority, it's like, well, what do you do? And that's very frustrating to be in that situation. We're trying to do it right. They're voting an ideology, and it makes it challenging.
So you mentioned President Trump one more term and so on and so forth. What would your plans be after one more term? Would you like to announce anything or talk about that?
No, Dan, I'm not. You never know what tomorrow will bring. And God, I do my best to do what every day, ask God what he wants me to do. And when it comes to those big decisions, I certainly have, gifts and talents that God has given me, and he expects a return on that investment. Matthew 25 is my life chapter of the Bible. And Schelzig and those guys, those rabid liberals, they all say I'm ambitious. I'm ambitious to please God, and I'm ambitious to do the right thing, and I'm ambitious to make a difference. And I don't really care where. I mean, I don't have a heart to be in a job. I have a heart to make a difference, and I'm going to go wherever I think God calls me to make a difference. And if that means even taking one for the team, I'll do it. Because for me, it's about making a difference, and that's what life is about. So that's why I'll weigh that every single day for the next several months, and when a door opens, we'll walk through it.
Well, I think you are making a difference, and I think that even though Schumer is not going to take this up, I believe that your hard work, your months of hard work, has paid off in the sense that you have painted the story of how Mayorkas and Biden are trying to steal future elections, in my opinion, increase their representation in the House of Representatives. Whole other conversation as we just had. There's other things involved as well. But I do appreciate you being on, and wish you the best of luck. And thanks again for being on Nashville's Morning News.
Thanks, Dan. And by the way, I never forget an interview with you.
Oh, aren't you sweet? Thank you very much, Congressman Green. We'll talk to you next time. All right, bye-bye. Yeah. All right, very good. 8:23 on Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Couldn't get him to say that he's running for governor or whatever it is. I just,
Well, you tried, Brother Dan.
I did. Would you like to announce anything now? And it's like, no, I don't want to announce anything now.
Yeah, you should have tried a trick question.
I should have, but I'm not that smart. And I'm certainly not going to be able to outsmart Congressman Mark Green.
No, he's pretty savvy.
He's got a few points on me as far as smart goes. So, but I do find it interesting that he's gone through the whole thing about should I retire, should I unretire? He unretires, and then he gets this big job, and then Schumer's not going to take it anywhere, and you feel like that whole thing was for naught. And I think that number one, he has a lot to be proud of because he really did paint the picture of why Mayorkas should be impeached. And I would say Joe Biden, too, quite frankly. But that's for, people on a higher pay scale than yours truly. Anyway, 8:24, Nashville's Morning News on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. And I want to tell you about my friends at the Kellum Stem Cell Institute. Listen, it is spring. And if you've lost that spring in your step because of sports injuries, the Kellum Stem Cell Institute can help you with those nagging injuries and so much more. So my question to you would be, what ails you? Maybe it's autism. Maybe it is those sports injuries like concussions, or maybe Lou Gehrig's disease, congestive heart failure, asthma, arthritis, and so much more. Well, there's good news now from the Kellum Stem Cell Institute that can help you. Dr. Ethan Kellum specializes in the harvesting of and then redeploying of your own stem cells to attack inflammation in your body to help it heal. This is your body providing your cells and your solutions, and Dr. Ethan Kellum can help you today. They do now accept CareCredit as well. You can find them online. It's K-E-L-L-U-M, KellumStemCellInstitute.com. This is your body, your cells, and your solution. That phone number, tell them I told you to reach out, 615-850-4415, 615-850-4415, the Kellum Stem Cell Institute. 825, Ken Weaver, what's coming up in the news?
Well, we'll let you hear more of what Congressman Mark Green had to say about the likelihood of a full impeachment trial of Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas. We'll also tell you why commuters in Williamson County can expect them to be longer. Details at 830 on Super Talk 99.7 WTN.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Matt Murphy for Members Nutrition. I want to tell you about the Members Nutrition difference, and I want to encourage you to go over to the Members Nutrition website. Number one, they believe at Members Nutrition that they can sell vitamins and supplements at a lower cost point, and they're doing it every single day at membersnutrition.com. Number two, they want to make these products right here in the United States of America, not from some overseas company, and they do that every single day. I encourage you to go to membersnutrition.com. You'll get 50% off your purchase price at checkout. You don't have to put in any codes. Just go to membersnutrition.com. Once again, membersnutrition.com.
What an absolute mess. Hey, it's Dan Mandis. Look at my closets. Unorganized to say the least. Even my window dormer is a train wreck. Stuff is everywhere. Now, luckily, California Closets is coming to my rescue. My personal design consultant, Vince, stopped by, measured, and is now showing me how to become more space efficient and organized on his 3D CAD system. It is amazing. And soon, my space is going to be organized. And yes, even Bandit approves. California Closets, a local company that can customize the storage in any room of your house. California Closets, what can they do for you? Find them online at californiaclosets.com and reach out for your free in-home consultation.
A29 Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Dan Mandis here, joining the Members Nutrition bandwagon because there's so much this organization can do to make you healthier. We're talking about vitamins and supplements that are both affordable and effective. Now, I do have trouble relaxing and resting and sleeping. So I went to membersnutrition.com and I ordered me some Ultra Mood. Now, that's going to help me relax. Those melatonin sleep aids also going to help me sleep. Now, I'm a big believer in being healthy, staying healthy, and taking care of myself. Members Nutrition is the company that is going to help me do just that, and they can help you as well. Now, what can they help you with? They've got supplements for energy, immune boosting, sports nutrition, and so much more for both men and women. So check them out today, membersnutrition.com. That's membersnutrition.com.
8:30 on the dot. I'm Ken Weaver with your top stories. Full forecast and traffic in 5 minutes. 8:40 east in Williamson County is going to be closed for months to fix a bridge at Thompson Station. At least one lane will be open on the interstate, but drivers are still asked to take the exit 23 detour. And if you have to be in Chattanooga today, you might want to leave a little earlier, allow yourself some extra time. 24 is down to one lane both directions at Mont Eagle due to a crash. Later today in our nation's capital, Tennessee Congressman Mark Green, who led the impeachment of Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas in the House, fires back at Democrats in the Senate who say there's no evidence of high crimes related to illegal immigration at the southern border.
He's abused his position to force his immigration agenda onto the people of the country when the people of the country voted on something different through their elected officials in the Congress.
Green tells WTN's Nashville's Morning News Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer will certainly move to dismiss the case to protect President Biden's reelection effort. And Boeing on the hot seat on Capitol Hill today in two congressional hearings aimed to look at recent mechanical and structural issues with its jets. Market Numbers Report. Market Numbers brought to you by Beacon Capital Management. Online at beaconcm.com. We're a couple of minutes into the brand new trading day. And right now, the Dow is up 93. The S&P up 19. NASDAQ up 68. That's the latest news. Traffic and weather next. I'm Ken Weaver, WTN News.
Thank you, Ken. 832 Supertalk 99.7. So we've been talking about the Glock store and the great events they have, most notably their incredible annual open house. It's going to be their fourth. Coming up fast, it's going to be on Saturday, June 1st. Make sure that you are saving the date. I'm going to be there. Chris and Matt will be there as well. They also do all kinds of events at the Glock store. Great facility. And coming up this Saturday, the Davidson County Republican Party is holding their annual Shooting Stars fundraiser. And so you can meet and greet some of the local Republicans. They're going to have shooting competitions as well. Terrific prizes and a chance to win a Glock 43X. Now, what I want you to do is go to GOPNashville.com and click on Shooting Stars to get your tickets. Matt Murphy is going to be there around 6 that evening as well. You want to hold an event at an incredible and unique facility. Call my friends at the Glock store. Check them out at GlockStore.com. That phone number is 615-682-6565, 615-682-6565. Tell them Dan Mandis told you to reach out. 8:38, Nashville's morning news on Super Talk 99.7 WTN. Time for the Gang of Four Amigos. You guys all right over there?
No.
Wow.
Are you looking at the article that I sent you guys?
Yes, we are.
I just tweeted it out. So Johnny, Ken, Chris is here as well. Follow
that
me on.
That is macabre.
At Dan Mandis Show.
Yeah, if you want a spoiler alert on what we're looking at.
So
I hear Alice Cooper singing, "I love the dead."
Well, you know, this is how Democrats get dead people to vote for them.
That's right.
So, wow. All right, we're doing the jokes before we've told the story.
Yes,
there is,
are.
If you check out my at Dan Mandis Show, this was in Brazil.
Which completely tracks, by the way.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
A woman wheels in a corpse.
Wow.
A literal dead person into a bank and tries to get him to sign off on a loan in her name while holding
goodness.
His head up in front of a very suspicious bank teller. And they say, well, he looks very pale.
Yeah, he doesn't look well.
Yeah, he looks a little peaked.
Wow.
You never go full Weekend at Bernie's at the bank.
No. And you know what? If you're going to try that, you know, put some whatever on their face to make them look more alive.
She didn't even put sunglasses on the guy.
No.
Like, that's step one.
Yeah. Yes. At least Bernie was smiling.
Yeah. And two people were holding him up.
This guy's mouth pops wide open as his head flops back.
Goodness. I mean, she rolls this guy in a wheelchair.
Oh,
and
gosh.
She's trying to make it. She's got like the pen by his hand.
Oh.
You know? Yeah, you got a sign right here. And like the bank tellers are like, he looks pale and he's not really moving. And we're a little suspicious of all of this.
Yeah, the DNC just wants to know, is it possible to get him up here to run?
I was going to say. DNC is like, well, maybe we should try this.
This is a prime candidate for a Biden flight.
That's exactly right.
And a vice presidential pick.
You know what's going to happen is the DNC is going to see this story and they're going to get a bunch of wheelchairs and go to the morgue and just get a bunch of people and take them to the voting place. That's probably what they're going to do. Am I taking it too far? Okay, moving on.
No, they'll just put ballots in a bucket somewhere on a telephone pole.
Yeah, that too.
The old ballots in a bucket trick.
Yep.
We've seen that before.
You know what the funny thing is? At least she dressed him nice.
Are you sure?
I don't know. He's got a hospital smock.
He's got a Calvin Klein shirt on, it looks like.
Yeah, he's got a Calvin Klein shirt.
Oh, my gosh, it is.
It says CK. Here's the funny thing. I wouldn't even be caught dead in a Calvin Klein shirt, yet he had to be dead, and she put one on him.
Yeah, you might, Dan.
Wasn't that the whole marketing thing? Like, see me in my Calvins, right? Isn't that the whole thing?
No, maybe
I'm missing it.
She is in a hurry because he's already been dead for 2 hours. So rigor mortis is going to start kicking in.
Maybe as rigor mortis sets in, she can stick a pen in his hand. And
well, that's what she tries.
It'll grasp the pen, and then she can try to make him sign it.
Wow. Interesting.
People will do anything.
Is it wrong to laugh at this? Suddenly feeling like maybe we shouldn't be laughing at this. But,
poor
I mean,
man.
It's hard to not laugh.
I think it's funny.
I do. I think it's funny.
I'm of the opinion we laugh at everything or we laugh at nothing.
Well,
there you go.
Yes.
Very good, Chris.
That's pretty true, man. I mean, yeah, you got to laugh to keep from crying nowadays.
And the way she leans in when she realizes the teller is video recording and smiles.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
This woman, she ought to be a White House press secretary.
Kevin says she took Biden to a bank.
I want to know how much the loan they were asking for was.
Yes.
Yeah. What? I think it says
17,000 Brazilian reais, 2,500 pounds or 2,500 euros. I don't know. Whatever that weird symbol is.
Yeah.
I don't know, but it's pretty funny.
Oh, it's very funny.
Now, here's the funny thing. I wonder if they gave her the money. Obviously not.
Hopefully doubt it. Now, when I was buying a car, I was told by the gentleman that was selling me the car that, because I asked him, I said, any bizarre incidents ever happen in a transaction? He said, I had a girl that came in that did not have good credit. and she was going to get a cosign from her grandmother, said the woman left, came back dressed as an old woman.
Oh, no.
Yes. He said he could tell it was the same girl.
Wow.
But she was trying to pass herself off as her grandmother. People do crazy things.
Oh, listen. Not to get, I'll say it this way.
All right.
You know, when you sometimes you'll have like relatives who are well beyond where Biden is in their dementia.
Yes.
And you got family members that will come in and try to say, oh, sign this. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And it's just, it's horrific the things that people do for money.
Oh, it is.
It is awful.
So 2,500 euros is only $2,660. So imagine going through all that
for
less than $3,000.
Man.
Man. All right. That's funny. I mean, it's not, but it is. I'm sorry. I just
if you're going to risk that and go through all that work,
yes. Right,
it's worth a little bit more than that.
Yeah, make it worth your while.
Make it an even 10, 5 or 10, right?
She really thought this was going to work. That's what amazes me about some crimes that people commit is they convince themselves somehow it's going to work.
Yeah, that's the other thing. Like, they actually thought this was a good idea.
Yes.
They also believe that Johnny needs some audio. Biden's campaign also thought it would be a good idea to allow Joe Biden to speak.
One day I showed up at Off Year Convention, and I was in the motel after the local motel getting changed after the afternoon session, go back to the evening session. Yeah. I'd come down with some young activists, a little older than me, but still young activists, were involved in trying to reform the party.
That's
and
my favorite part.
I was in one of those 8x10 bathrooms, you know, they have shower, toilet, and a sink. And
sure.
I got a towel on me and shaving cream, and I hear bam, bam, bam at my door really loudly. And I wonder, what the hell is that? I thought it was this guy, Bob Cunningham, had a radio show, and a couple other guys. So I said, okay, guys. And I walked to the door and opened it up, and standing there was the former governor of the state of Delaware, Albert N. Carville, a big guy, about 6'5", talked at you like, yes. And the state representative who got defeated 4 years earlier.
You know what's funny about that? I'm going to let him finish. But when he is impersonating the governor, he actually sounds better than himself. You know what I mean?
My favorite part is he goes, I was with a young activist who's older than me.
Yeah.
thinks she wants to reform the government.
Right.
Thinks she's going to reform the party.
Uh-huh, yeah.
That's a Democratic state rep who was retired. And one of the, from the family that had more senators appointed than any other family in American history, to the tunnels, a former retired justice. And the state chairman. And they said, I'm standing with a towel and shaving cream on my face.
Yeah, he's standing there with a towel and shaving cream on his face.
What did the young activists that he was with have to do with the story?
Yeah.
And why were they in the hotel room?
Here's the funny thing. Nobody knows why he told the story. Like, he's telling the story, but there was no reason to tell the story.
Right. Yeah, he described the bathroom.
Yes.
Why did he have to describe the bathroom?
8x10.
And why?
Toilet, shower, and sink. And
yeah, that sounds like a bathroom, Joe.
That checks out. Thanks, Joe, for confirming that.
Man, I should have done that back in the 80s. You know, pop in the living room with nothing but a towel. I'm here to reform the party, boys and girls.
Well, why were you in the activist?
Let's get some of that reform.
Why were you in the activist in a motel room to begin with?
I don't know.
Activists just waiting on you to get done showering? Or?
She wanted to reform the party.
is that what they call it these days?
Yeah. By the way, Governor Albert Nostrand Burt Carville died in 2005. He was 95 years old.
Wow.
So
obviously seeing Biden in a towel didn't kill him.
Well, might have.
They wheeled him up. He was in a wheelchair with a Calvin Klein shirt on, and they were holding his head up.
Oh, man. And why was he banging on the door? Was the young activist maybe a daughter or
family member of some kind? See, here's the funny thing. We're laughing, but you know how Biden doesn't always tell the truth of the full story or none of the truth story. You don't really know.
Wow.
What's going on with Joe?
It's just, man.
There's a young activist older than me.
Oh, there has got to be a debate. There has to be a debate.
And well, you know, there has to be a debate, but they also have to figure out a way to delay the debate so that whatever they give them, like, starts to wear off.
Yes.
Did we joked, was that on the air or off the air when we joked about, you know, giving Biden a bump?
I think that was on the air.
Was that on the air?
It was on the air.
Okay. Biden bump.
Yeah, Biden
bump. The Biden bump.
Biden bump. There you go.
Oh, man.
They're going to need something strong for a debate.
Yeah, they are.
Two bumps.
They'll have to hold it at 10 o'clock in the morning.
It's like, well, remember the Republican debates where during the commercial breaks, you saw them powdering DeSantis's nose? It's going to be something like that for Joe.
Yeah, have to have Hunter, you know, out of camera shot.
Listen. Powdering his nose.
Yeah, powdering. We're dead.
Joe's got two nostrils, right? A bump for each nostril. That's what needs to happen.
Thanks, Sean.
Interesting, man.
Chris, what do you have for this segment?
I found a story that I thought was interesting. Their experts are predicting that there's going to be a $1 billion market for AI girlfriends.
Wow. Yeah.
So this is a tech executive.
Wait,
his name is...
AI girlfriends.
Yeah. Artificial intelligence girlfriends.
No, I know. I'm just trying to figure out how that works.
So I don't know.
Yeah, there'll be a robot involved.
I mean,
sure.
I think it's just online conversation until there's robots.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I believe it.
I would too.
Okay.
We need to get started on that, boys.
A lot of lonely men out there.
No, I'm laughing. People watching the Super Talk TV, I'm laughing because it's like...
A lot of questions.
You're going to go get an artificial intelligence a girlfriend to talk.
But listen, this is crazy. So the tech executive, Greg Eisenberg, he's the CEO of Late Checkout. He shared this encounter he had with a 24-year-old guy in Miami. And this 24-year-old guy is admitting to spending $10,000 per month on AI girlfriends.
Good grief, man.
My gosh.
What are we doing?
Okay, so what is an AI? Can I just ask? I'll be the one to ask the dumb question. So what does an AI girlfriend actually do for you? If you're spending $10,000 for an AI girlfriend... Then, I mean, are you just talking?
Yeah, I would imagine so.
All right. How many women out there are like, man, I'll talk to somebody for $10,000?
Virtual partners can engage in conversations, provide emotional support, and even participate in erotic role play, depending on the user's preferences.
Goodness gracious.
But I lead in what you said. I'm sure that there's... Some ladies out there that would take $10,000 a month.
Absolutely.
Well, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, all right, let's turn it around. Johnny, Ken, Chris, if some rich widow wanted to spend thousands of dollars and wanted somebody to talk to, would you talk to somebody for a lot of money?
Yeah.
A younger me would oblige them.
Yeah.
There you go.
I'd talk to them. Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. How was your day? That'll be $5, you know? Okay.
How's your day?
This is getting so weird.
There's those memes on the internet where it's like a sad teenager and an older woman in the bed. And she says, that wasn't so bad, was it? Let's go get you that PS5.
All right, see, that's funny. That's funny.
Oh, man. We're headed. We think we're in weird times right now.
You know, listen, Lord. Lindsay says she would absolutely talk to somebody for on the Members Nutrition Super Text line. She said, absolutely, I would talk to somebody for money.
Well, I mean, we've talked about how much money women are making by putting pictures of their feet online.
Exactly. This is true.
And you have actresses now that are, you know, when they hit hard times, they go to, what is it, OnlyFans?
Yeah.
Kat says she would. My husband would encourage.
Well.
In the Joe Biden economy.
Yeah,
Listen, we all need side gigs, right?
Yeah, we do.
And actually, Chris, if you think about it, all of us, if you think about it, we actually do talk to people for money.
This is fair.
Not a whole lot, but.
And it doesn't turn them on, but.
Man, I hope not. Maybe we can play more Joe Biden.
If you read the members' nutrition text line, it's a lot more turning off, depending upon what we say.
Man, that is so true. Very good.
goodness. I cannot wait to hear you expound on that, Brother Chris.
Yes,
that
sure.
That is going to be good.
Speaking of which, Chris has a lot of women on his show today.
I got a lot of ladies stopping by the show today. We have Bernadette Pager. She's the Tennessee Director of Stand for Health Freedom. She's going to talk to us, give us an update on a bill we talked about on Monday and another bill going through the Tennessee legislature today. We're also going to talk to Savannah Hernandez. She's a front lines reporter. She is on the ground in New York City covering illegal immigration and the Trump trial. She is a fantastic reporter. There's a video of her where a city employee says, "What are you doing?" And she goes, "Well, we're covering the illegal alien crisis." And he goes, "Well, that's not a very nice thing to say." This is a New York City employee.
Oh, Lord.
Savannah Hernandez is 5'6", 5'5". She's chasing down this New York City male employee, and he is running. She put the fear of God in this man when he found out that she's a reporter and she's filming this. And he basically jumps a fence and
oh my God.
runs through a grassy knoll area. I think it's like right outside of City Hall in New York to flee this 5 foot something woman. It was fantastic. So we're going to talk to her about
that's
that.
That's awesome.
And then we have, I'm blanking her name. Sarah McAbee. She is the wife of the J6 political prisoner, Ronald McAbee. She's going to give us an update on her husband, and she's also going to enlighten us on the Fisher v. United States arguments.
854, Supertalk 99.7, Chris Hand coming up next. Dan Mandis here with a question for you. If your roof was destroyed in a storm, how much of that replacement cost would your insurance company cover? Now, if you don't know, you really do need to ask, because some insurance companies refuse to pay full replacement cost. They're going to deduct money for an older roof, and this means that the insurance company is depreciating how much they pay for your roof claim. Now, that could leave you on the hook for thousands of dollars. Now, my friends at King & Associates Insurance, they will pay full replacement cost. So whether you have to replace a 20-year-old roof or a 2-year-old roof, they pay for it to be replaced, period. It is that kind of focus on customer service that makes King & Associates Insurance one of the absolute best insurance companies around. So call them and tell them Dan Mandis told you to reach out, 615-329-8121, 615-329-8121. Get your royal review, tkinginsurance.com.